Chapter 1, Part A of The Delafield Affair. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Delafield Affair, by Florence Finch Kelly. Chapter 1, Part A, Vengeance Avowed. Curtis Conrad turned from superintending repairs on the adobe wall and walked across the corral to the gate of the opposite side. As he filled his pipe, he looked across the wide, greenish-gray New Mexican plateau stretching far to east and south and west. It was dotted here and there with little groups of grazing cattle, and he noted a straggling procession of the creatures, their figures wavering and distorted in the heat haze, coming down from the distant foothills. They were following a trail that cut across the plain in a straight line to the pond across the road from the house, beyond a grove of cottonwood trees. "Poor devils," he thought. "They're tramping miles for a drink of water, and tomorrow they'll tramp back again for their breakfast. The Castletons are going to lose big money in dead cattle this summer unless there's more rain than there was last. It's awful to see the poor brutes dropping in their tracks. I'll begin looking for a job in wetter country if this summer doesn't bring more rain." He turned his attention to his pipe, sheltering bowl and match in his hollowed hand. "No use in this wind," he muttered. "What a blast it's blowing today. Well, there's no sand in it." The plain stretched away from the ranch house in low, rolling hills, so evenly sized that it gave the impression of a level surface. Up from one of the little valleys rose a horseman, as if he had sprung suddenly from the depths of the earth. Through the heat that wavered over the plain, his horse's legs drew out into long, knobby sticks, and both man and steed became an absurd caricature of the sinewy pony and cowboy rider that presently cantered up to the gate with the mail for which Conrad had been waiting. "Three cow brutes are down on the pond trail just where it crosses the road. One of 'em's got a calf."
"Are they dead?"
"Mighty nigh. We'll be by night." "You and Red Jack go and skin them in the morning." Conrad turned toward the house, looking at his letters. His mind still lingered over the calf. "Poor little devil. It ought to have a chance," he was thinking, when his eye caught the name on one of the envelopes. He turned upon the cowboy, a gaze suddenly grown preoccupied. "No, Peters," he said. "The calf won't go with the other cattle while its mother is alive, and I saw that gray wolf skulking along the draw this afternoon. You and Red Jack better go down now and put the cows out of their misery. Skin them, and bring the calf into the corral till night, and then put it down by the pond with the other cow brutes." His eyes quickly returned to the letter that had attracted his attention. "Tremper and Townsend!" he exclaimed with eager surprise. "Why, they were Delafield's attorneys!" He tore open the envelope with an impatient jerk, and the rushing wind almost blew from his fingers the check it contained. As his eye ran quickly down the half-dozen lines of the letter, his face lighted with satisfaction and amusement. The sound of a carriage distracted his attention. It turned in at his house gate, and he hastened forward, a lean, long-legged figure of a man, hat doffed and hand outstretched. "How are you, Bancroft? Good to see you. Of course you're coming in. Thirsty? I'll bet you are. And you know we've got the best water in Silverside County here. How much better your daughter's looking, Alec. If you keep on like this, Miss Bancroft, you'll soon forget you were ever ill." "Oh, I've forgotten that already. There's such magic in the winds you have here," the girl replied laughingly as he lifted her to the ground. "They're strong enough to blow the past out of your memory and make you forget even your own name." Her father suddenly turned away and began to hitch the horses. He sent back a covert glance at her as she stood at Conrad's side, a slender figure, her face still thin from recent illness but aglow with the pink of returning health, the breeze fluttering the short brown curls that clustered over her bare head. "Oh, my hat, please," she exclaimed with sudden remembrance of the head covering she had left hanging in the carriage top. Curtis took it down for her and looked on with undisguised admiration while she tied it with a big bow of ribbon under her chin. Bancroft came back, explaining that they had driven since mid-forenoon from the base of Mangan's Peak, and asking if Conrad did not think they had made pretty good time with their new team of horses. Curtis looked them over critically, praising their good points, and approving heartily when Bancroft told him they had been bought for both riding and driving, for he wanted Lucy, now that she was growing strong again, to become an expert horsewoman. A big cottonwood tree grew beside the gate, and a little plot of grass, enclosed on three sides by whitewashed adobe walls, made a square of welcome green. Lucy Bancroft exclaimed with delight as they entered the tiny yard, stepping mincingly across the grass with lifted gown, and smiling back at the two men, while fleeting dimples played hide-and-seek in her cheeks. "I'm so glad, Mr. Conrad," she laughed, "that you haven't any signs up to keep off the grass, for I simply must walk on it. I never saw anything so lovely as this little lawn, and this beautiful big green tree, after our long ride across the plain. It makes me think of that line in the Bible about the shadow of a great rock in a weary land." "Yes," replied Curtis as he threw open the door. "I never knew until I came to New Mexico how much comfort and pleasure there can be in a few blades of grass. When I come in from a long ride and look at this little checkerboard square of turf, I feel as if I uncurled a whole yard of wrinkles and squints from around my eyes." The Socorro Springs ranch house was a rambling sequence of adobe rooms, so joined one to another that they formed the eastern and part of the northern side of the big square corral. It was low and flat-roofed, and struggling tufts of weeds and grass grew along the top and trailed over the edge, adding their chapter to nature's endless tale of the unwearied determination of life to evade and overcome death. The rooms opened out of one another in a long row, all with outside doors looking toward the east and some with additional doors into the corral. A bare adobe yard sloping eastward was bordered by a trickling stream of water along which grew some willows and cottonwoods. Beyond it spread a golden green field of young alfalfa, and beyond that the greenish-gray plain stretched to the far horizon. Across the front of the house was a narrow wooden porch, and house and porch, walls and sheds, were all a dazzling white that in the vivid sunshine smote the sight like a blow across the eyeballs. In the low, large room in front, gaily colored Navajo rugs were spread on the floor. White muslin curtains hung at the windows, and rose-bedecked paper covered the walls and ceiling. Unpainted shelves of pine above a battered, flat-topped desk were filled with books, and the round table in the middle of the room was littered with newspapers, magazines, tobacco pouches, and pipes. The housekeeper, Mrs. Peters, brought a pitcher of water, and Conrad explained to Lucy that the springs from which the ranch took its appellation, Los Ojos del Socorro, the Springs of Succor, had been so named nearly 300 years before by a party of Spanish explorers, because they had come unexpectedly upon the pure waters when they were almost dead from thirst. At the housekeeper's suggestion, Lucy went into the next room to lie down for a half-hour's rest before they should start for their home in Golden, 20 miles farther westward. The door, accidentally left ajar, swung part way open, and she could hear plainly the voices of her father and Conrad as she lay with eyes closed and thoughts wandering, scarcely heeding what they said. The two men were absorbed in a discussion of local politics. "Dan Tillinghurst is all right," said Conrad. "He's made a good sheriff, and he ought to have the office again. I shall do all I can to have him renominated and to help elect him afterwards. But Delmy Baxter for Congress again? That's where I buck, and buck hard, and keep a buckin'." "But he's the head of the party in the territory," objected Bancroft. "He can bring out more votes than any other man we can put up. If we turn him down in the convention, they'll beat us at the polls." "We'll deserve to be beaten if we nominate him anyway. I can't stomach him any longer, Alec, and I don't see how you can." "Oh, you're prejudiced, Curt," said the other good-naturedly. "You know you can never see any good in a man you dislike, and you took a dislike to Baxter the first day you set foot in the territory." "Maybe I am prejudiced, but in Del Baxter's case there's ample reason to be, and I'd be ashamed of myself if I wasn't. I know he's a friend of yours, but that doesn't prevent him from being the worst scoundrel in the whole territory. I tell you, Alec, there's nothing that man wouldn't do unless it was something square and honest." "Come, come, Curt. That's rank exaggeration. I've been associated with Del Baxter financially ever since I located in this part of the country, and I've always found him strictly on the square." "Then it was because it was to his interest to be square. He'll do you up yet if he gets the chance and thinks it worthwhile. He's had his finger in every crooked scheme that's been put through from Raton to El Paso, and his hands are as bloody as his pockets are dirty." Don't you think it's going a little too far, asked Bancroft, smiling calmly, to accuse a man in that wholesale way when you haven't any basis for your assertions but the merest idle gossip? Conrad gave an indignant snort. Oh, I'm not saying he's done the jobs himself. He thinks too much of that fat paunch of his to put that into any danger. But why does he keep those Mexican thugs hanging around him, if it isn't to use them for things he wouldn't dare to do himself? Why, I heard from Santa Fe only last week that he's taken into his pay that Mexican cutthroat Liberato Herrera, whom he saved last winter from conviction for the Paxton murder. No, Alec, he went on, I buck when it comes to Del Baxter for Congress again. If he gets the nomination and the other side puts up Johnny Martinez, as it's likely they will, I'm going to support Johnny. But he's a Mexican. I don't care what he is, as long as he's a decent man. He won't be a disgrace to the territory in Washington, and that's more than you can say of Baxter. Bancroft's impassive face lighted with a bantering smile. There's no limit to your bad opinion of a man, is there, Curt, if he once gets into your disfavor? By the way, is it true that the Castletons are behind Johnny Martinez? I don't know, and I don't care. I'm their hired man here on the ranch, but my vote's my own, and so's what little influence I may have. And I'll do with both of 'em just what I damn please, and if it came to a showdown, I'd be perfectly willing to lose my job if that would keep Del Baxter from going back to Congress. Bancroft laughed again. Conrad's eye, as he turned to his desk for more cigars, fell upon the little pile of letters and papers he had just received. On the top lay the Tremper and Townsend envelope. By the way, Alec, you're from Boston, ain't you? He exclaimed impulsively. In the next room, Lucy, listening sleepily to the two voices, had been noting the difference in their quality. Conrad's was high and clear, his speech rapid and incisive, her father's lower and more deliberate, had in it a subtle persuasive quality. "Dear Daddy," she whispered softly, her heart warm with affection. Then the new sharp edge in Conrad's tone gripped her attention and sent her eyes flying open. Wide awake on the instant, she listened for the sound of her father's voice again. Had she been on the scene, she might have noted that he turned an instant's keen gaze upon his companion before he answered carelessly enough, "Yes, originally. But I've come from so many other places since then that I almost forget it, unless somebody reminds me. I haven't been back there or known much about the old place for years." Conrad's boyish smile illuminated his face and twinkled in his blue eyes. "Yes," he said. "Most everybody out here is so everlastingly on the lope that it's no wonder some of 'em lose their names every once in a while and have to pick up most anything that comes handy. I'm no exception, though I've not yet forgotten what was my name back in the States. But did you know anything about the Delafield Affair in Boston 15 or 16 years ago?" End of Chapter 1, Part A. Chapter 1, Part B of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 1, Part B, Vengeance Avowed. I heard of it at the time, but it was after I left the city. It was so long ago that I forget the details. Skipped, didn't he, with a lot of funds? Or was he the one who defaulted and jumped into the Charles River? Conrad had an eagerness of speech and manner that in a man of less vigor would have been accounted nervousness. Voice, face, and gesture were alive with it as he responded, "Jumped nothing, except to get out of reach of his creditors. He's alive yet and making money somewhere, and I mean to find him. I've got a particular interest in that man, and when I come up with him, he'll have a particular interest in me, for I'm going to give him such a song and dance as he's never had before." Bancroft listened calmly, his face and manner as impassive as usual, but his eyes narrowed as they met his companion's excited gaze. Smiling slightly, he replied, "What has he done to stir you up so? You must have been too young to be interested in financial investments then." "So I was, directly. Nevertheless, it happens, Alec, that the Delafield affair has influenced me in my life more than any other one thing. My father lost everything he had in Sumner L. Delafield's smash-up. I was 15 years old then, and getting ready to go to Michigan University. Afterward, I was to study law and be a prominent citizen. My father met Delafield first during a business trip to Boston. We lived in central Illinois, and father was well-to-do. And just like everybody else, he gave the man his entire confidence. You remember, of course, how Delafield came to the top as a regular young Napoleon of business and soon made a reputation as one of the big financiers. When he turned up missing one fine morning, and it was found that the bottom had dropped out of everything, most people believed he had killed himself, but he hadn't. I happen to know, and he's still alive. Well, my father had been so influenced by Delafield, the fellow must have been a persuasive cuss, that he had put everything he could raise into the man's schemes, and had even mortgaged our home. He had a weak heart, and when he read the news of Delafield's default and disappearance, he fell out of his chair dead. The sudden shock of it all prostrated my mother, and she died in giving premature birth to a child. So there was I, a 15-year-old boy, suddenly dropped to the bottom of poverty, with two younger sisters and a little brother to take care of. I tell you, I swore vengeance on that man. I promised myself I'd hunt him down if it took a lifetime. I'm on his trail now, and I'm not going to leave it until I run him into his hole. Then I'm going to stand him up and call him to his face all he deserves, and give him a gun so he can have a fair chance for his worthless life, and take one myself, and then I'll put a bullet through his scoundrel brain if I have to hang for it afterward. In the adjoining room, Lucy Bancroft, with wide eyes and heightened color, was listening to Conrad's story. The thrill of keen-edged purpose in his tense and eager tones had set her nerves to vibrating until her body was a tremble. At his last sentence, Curtis brought his fist down on the table with a crash that almost startled her into outcry. A moment of silence followed, and then she heard her father's cool and even voice. "But suppose he should put one through yours first?" "Oh, he's welcome to do that if he can draw quicker or shoot straighter than I can. He'll get one through his head before the bail is over, and that's all I care about. The roundup's coming, and I reckon he knows it. For today I got a letter from Tremper and Townsend of Boston, who settled up his affairs after his disappearance, enclosing a check for $500, saying he wished it sent to me as the first installment of the amount he owed my father, which he hopes before long to be able to pay in full." Bancroft flicked the ash from his cigar with unusual care, looked at it with contemplative interest, and drew a whiff or two before he spoke. Turning to Conrad with a quizzical smile, he said, "Well, Curt, doesn't that rather take the edge off your purpose? Why are you still shaking your gory locks and roaring like a wounded bull at him when he's evidently doing the square thing by you? Why don't you let up on your chase and give him a chance?" "Not on your life," was Conrad's emphatic rejoinder. "It's too late in the game for me to take repentance and an honest purpose on the hoof. He's found out that I'm getting hot on the scent, and he wants to buy me off. That's all that check means. It's not the loss of the money that sticks in my craw. It's the deviltry he worked years ago. Whenever I find that he's discharging his debts to all his other creditors, who aren't after him hot foot, then I'll consent to wait for my parley until he has settled the whole score." Lucy rose from the bed, depressed with a vague sense of trouble. The longing seized her to be out of doors again, alone with her father on the wide plain, with the wind smiting her face and filling her lungs and making her forget everything but her own joy in being alive. She rubbed her eyes, smoothed her face, and forced herself to smile at the reflection in the mirror until her agitation was subdued. And presently, smiling and self-possessed, she opened the door into the front room, just as her father was finishing some friendly advice to Conrad. "Well, Curt, it's your affair," he had said, "and if you are so dead set on getting that kind of revenge, I suppose you'll go ahead and get it. But you better be careful. If this man is desperate, he might try to head you off by the same means, and you couldn't exactly blame him for objecting to being shot in his tracks, or for taking measures to keep you from doing it. For my part, I never thought revenge was a paying investment, and I still believe you're foolish to waste your time, energy, and money in that sort of business." "Ah, Lucy, is that you?" he went on as she opened the door. "Come in, dear. Have you had a nap, and do you feel better?" "Yes, thank you. I've rested beautifully, and I'm ready to start whenever you wish," she replied. Conrad produced a bottle of port wine, telling them as he filled their glasses that it had been sent him by a friend in California, in whose cellars it had lain for 20 years, and that it would be a good tonic for Miss Bancroft. The friend had promised to send him more, and with her permission he would take a bottle to her the next time he went to Golden. As they stepped out of the house, Lucy looked toward the west, whence the wind came, and as it struck her full in the face, she gasped for breath, and her slender body swayed in its rushing current. She grasped her wide hat brim with both hands and held it down so that it made a frame for her face. Laughing with joy, she turned to Curtis. "Oh, I love these winds, Mr. Conrad. I know they blow sand into your eyes and pelt your face with gravel, but they make you feel so good. I always want to dance when I've been out in a wind like this for a minute or two." She took half a dozen dancing steps across the little lawn. "And they are so pure and sweet," she went on more seriously, "and make you feel so right, that it seems as if they ought to blow all the wickedness out of one's mind." "Jiminy, I wonder if she heard what I said in there," thought Conrad, with inward panic. But he smiled down at her glowing young face, and his eyes shone with admiration as he replied, "That is a beautiful theory, Miss Bancroft, but I'm afraid it doesn't pan out much in practice. It rather seems to me that most people who come to New Mexico have that sort of thing blown into them instead of out of them. As for myself," and he grinned broadly, "I can't say that I feel any increase in righteousness, no matter how much I waltz around in these zephyrs." "And you must have given them a fair trial, too," she laughed back. "But you may make all the fun you like of my little pet theory, Mr. Conrad. I shall believe in it just the same, and like the country just as much." No, she didn't hear, and besides, she said she'd been asleep, so it's all right, thought Curtis with much relief as he went on eagerly. "I'm glad you're pleased with us and our winds, so that you'll want to stay. I assure you, Miss Bancroft, you can't find such a superior quality of wind anywhere else in the United States." "Oh, I'm going to stay, not on account of the wind, but on account of my father, who I assure you, Mr. Conrad, is the most superior quality of father to be found anywhere in the United States. I've been away from him so much that now I'm perfectly happy to be with him all the time. You see, when my dear mother died 5 years ago, father put me in a boarding school, and afterward sent me to Chicago for a year to study music, and there I had that attack of typhoid fever that came so near to killing me. But I'm here with him at last, and I mean to stay. And I'm learning to ride now, Mr. Conrad, and father thinks I'm getting on very well, don't you, Daddy?" She turned to her father, as he came beside them at the carriage wheel, with a fond smile and a touch of her hand upon his arm. "Oh, yes," he answered, returning her smile and patting her shoulder. "You are doing bravely, Lucy. You'll soon be scouring the plain like the heroine of a dime novel." "No New Mexican girl," said Conrad, as he helped her into the carriage, "thinks she can really ride until she can rope a steer. If you're going to be such an enthusiastic New Mexican, you'll have to learn tricks of that sort. Get your father to bring you out here some day, and I'll give you lessons in cowboy riding." "Agreed. That would be great fun," she exclaimed, smiling down at him, her eyes twinkling and the dimples dancing in and out of her cheeks. "We'll come out, won't we, Daddy, after Miss Dent comes? I shall remember your promise, Mr. Conrad." Curtis waved a last goodbye as they turned the corner of his corral and went back to his desk and his interrupted mail. "A mighty good fellow Alec Bancroft is," he said in a half-aloud tone. "He doesn't palaver a lot, but he makes you feel he's your friend. I wonder if I said too much about Delafield. That check had wound me up, and I sure talked more than I meant to. Long hours of solitude out of doors with only a silent plain around him and a silent sky above are likely to make a man so yearn for the sound of a human voice, though it be only his own, that he falls into the habit of thinking aloud. Conrad had the social temperament, and it had not taken the wide and silent spaces of earth and air long to engender in him the habit of making companionship out of his own speech. He pulled thoughtfully at his sunburned mustache for a moment as he considered the matter. "It might have been just as well if I hadn't said so much," he went on aloud. "But he's close-mouthed, and a good friend of mine. No, she didn't hear me, that's sure. How pretty she is when her eyes twinkle and her dimples come and go. I hope that wine will come in time for me to take her a bottle the next time I go to Golden. Well, I can call on her anyway, and apologize because it hasn't. Hello, here's a letter from Littleton. Has he got hold of something new about Delafield?" "I was down in the northern part of your territory last week on other business," he read, "and I happened to meet a man who is, I think, on the trail of the very same person we're after, though he's been working it from the other end. If I'm right about it, the man we want is now some prominent and respected citizen of New Mexico, and maybe some good friend or enemy of yours at this moment. The man I met is Rutherford W. Jenkins of Las Vegas. You probably know him." "Sure, and I know him to be a skunk," Conrad exclaimed with a contemptuous snort. "I couldn't get much out of him," the letter went on, "although I gave him a tip about the trail we're on and a little of Delafield's history as a bait. He snapped at it, and then began to dissemble his satisfaction, so I'm sure it is of value to him. But not even firewater would make him give up anything more. However, I feel pretty sure that he either knows already who Delafield is or expects soon to find out. I think he's working at it with an eye to the possibilities of blackmail of one sort or another. Perhaps if you see him yourself, you can get something out of him." Conrad's face glowed with satisfaction as he finished the letter. "The birds won't get a chance to make any nests in my hair this trip. I'll sashay up the line this very night and find out who Delafield is from Jenkins, if I have to choke the life out of him to do it. God!" His vengeful desire glowed like a blue flame in his eyes. He jumped to his feet, stretched out his arms, and clenched his fists. "Sumner L. Delafield, it's getting time for you to say your prayers." End of Chapter 1, Part B. Chapters 2 and 3 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapters 2 and 3. Chapter 2, The Evil That Men Do. Lucy Bancroft and her father were unusually silent as they drove toward home. After an effort to chatter gaily, she grew quiet, to her father's surprise, for she was ordinarily a vivacious companion. Speculating uneasily whether or not she had heard Conrad's story, and reassuring himself that it could mean nothing to her in any event, he made several efforts to draw her into speech, but she answered with her mind so evidently intent elsewhere that he gave up the attempt. The fear grew on him that she had overheard the conversation, and that it had left an undue impression on her mind. A mirage of singularly perfect illusion lay across the plain to their left, and he drew her attention to its silvery surface. The trees bordering its unreal banks, the cattle standing knee-deep in its waters, and the steamboat puffing across its breast. Lucy admired and wondered for a moment, then turned the other way and looked back at the green tree clusters and white buildings of the ranch they had left. Her gaze lingered there until they crossed the hill, and its summit hid the scene from view. Bancroft sought to reassure himself. Did she not say she had been asleep? And the door was shut. Surely she could not have heard. Even if she had, why should she care about it? Nevertheless, her silence made him anxious. It annoyed him to think that her mind was intent upon Conrad's story. He made another effort to draw her out of her abstraction by asking how soon she expected their friend, Louise Dent, who was coming to spend the summer with them. Lucy showed interest in this, and they discussed plans for her entertainment, but presently she fell silent again, looking straight ahead with a little frown on her brow. The conviction gripped Bancroft's mind that she had overheard the cattleman's recital of his wrongs. Alarm stirred in his heart as he tried to imagine what impression it had made upon her. Would she sympathize with Conrad? For the moment he forgot everything else, business deals and political contests, friendships and enmities, in his desire to know what had been the effect upon the girl beside him of Conrad's outburst. But much as he wished to know, he feared still more the surety of what her feeling might be, and he could not bring himself to ask the questions that would draw her out. Presently Lucy's voice broke suddenly upon their silence. "I wonder what became of his sisters." Her color rose as she spoke, and she gazed with exaggerated interest at a tall, yellow-flowered cactus beside the road. "Whose sisters, Lucy?" her father asked carelessly, flicking the horses to a faster pace, but his heart sank as he thought she did hear it all. "Why, Mr. Conrad's. You know he said he was left when he was only 15 with 2 younger sisters and a little brother to take care of." "Oh, Conrad, I don't know. They probably are married by this time. That was a long time ago. I've heard him mention his sisters before, I think. Yes, I recall now that he has told me they are both married and prosperous somewhere in Illinois or Iowa." "And his younger brother?" "Oh, he's just a young fellow, and Curtis is putting him through college. Conrad banks with me, and I've noticed his checks sometimes when they come back." "How good he is to them. It must have been very hard on him." Lucy's tone was sympathetic, but her father replied briskly, Oh, I don't know. Responsibility is sometimes just the thing to bring out all the good there is in a young fellow and show what sort of stuff he's made of. I suppose that's why he's never married, Lucy went on, following her own line of thought, her voice still sounding the sympathetic note, because he had to take care of the others. I don't suppose that's a fault in your eyes, my dear. Of course not, Daddy, Lucy flashed back, smiling and dimpling. Of course a girl likes a young man better because he's more interesting and can pay her more attention. You would yourself, Daddy, if you were a girl. Very likely, my dear. But I like Curtis Conrad well enough, even if I'm not as young as you are, and of your sex. I was disappointed in him today, though, and surprised as well. You must have heard what he said. How did it strike you to hear of a young man boast of his intention to commit murder? He spoke so earnestly, and the persuasive quality in his voice was so insistent, that Lucy turned upon him a quick look of surprise and question. Then her eyes fell as a sudden rush of emotion, coming she knew not whence or why, almost choked her utterance. "I don't know," she began tremulously. "Perhaps he wouldn't really do it. I don't believe he would. He seems too good and kind to be really wicked or cruel." She stopped a moment, only to break out abruptly. "And it was such a wicked thing that man Delafield did. Oh, he must have been a villain. As wicked and cruel, oh, as bad as he could be. I can't blame Mr. Conrad for feeling as he does. I know it seems an awful thing for me to say, but I really can't blame him, Daddy, when I think what that man made him suffer. And he was only one. There must have been many others. I might even feel the same way if I were in his place and it had been you that was killed." There was a thrill in her voice that seemed in her father's ears to be the echo of that which had vibrated through Curtis Conrad's words when he so passionately declared his purpose. Her words were as knife thrusts in his heart as she went on, "Oh, how I should hate him! I know I should hate him with all my strength." He made no immediate reply, leaning forward to tap the horses with the whiplash. Lucy choked down a sob or two, turned, threw her arms around his neck, and burst into tears. He put his arm about her with a sudden close pressure, and she, with her eyes hidden against his shoulder, could not see that his face had gone suddenly white, and that underneath his brown mustache and pointed beard, his lips were pale and tense. "Well, well, Lucy," he said presently, his voice calm and caressing, "there's no need to be tragic over it. Is it any of our affair, even if Conrad is our good friend? Possibly Delafield wasn't as bad as he says. It's likely Curt exaggerates about him. He usually does when he dislikes anybody. And perhaps Delafield suffered as much as the others. Come, dear, brace up, and don't be hysterical." Lucy straightened up and gave her father a wavering, wistful smile. "It was silly of me, wasn't it, Daddy, to act like that? I'm ashamed of myself. I don't know why I cried. I guess it was because I am tired." Chapter 3. Mistake or Blunder. With eager pleasure, Conrad gazed from his car window the next morning at the narrow, bright ribbon of verdure with which the Rio Grande pranks itself on its southward course through New Mexico. The unkempt fields, the orchards and meadows, and the softened and caressing sunlight were as balm to his eyes, accustomed to the pale, grim southern plain and its fierce white sunshine. As the train rushed northward along the banks of the muddy stream, he looked at the little adobe houses, wondering how long these peaceful Mexican homes could withstand the pressure of the dominant American. He became aware that the men behind him were discussing the same question. "It will be only a few years," one of them was saying, "until this rich valley with all this water for irrigation will be in American hands. The greasers are safe enough," said his companion, "until they begin to borrow on mortgages. Then their fate is settled." "I heard the other day," responded the first, "that Del Baxter's been corralling a lot of mortgages on the land hereabouts." The other chuckled. "You bet. Del ain't the man to let a little chance like this slip by him. These paisanos look on him as a sort of little father, and borrow money of him with utter heedlessness of the day of reckoning. He jollies them along and tells them they're good fellows and hard workers, and he's sure they'll be able to pay when the time comes. Of course, they never pay back a blessed peso, and Baxter gets the ranch. I'll bet it won't be long till he'll be exploiting a big land improvement company and selling these 'dobe farms for 10 times what they cost him." The talk of the two men drifted into politics, and presently Conrad heard them discussing Bancroft's loyal support of Baxter for Congress. "He's got to do it," said one of them. "Dell's been loaning him money and taking mortgages until Bancroft couldn't do anything else if he wanted to. Dell knows that Bancroft's support is a mighty important asset on account of the confidence people have in him, and Dell's been careful to cinch it good and tight." As Curtis bought an Albuquerque morning paper from the train boy, he thought indignantly, "That's all poppycock. Alex got too much grit to let anyone throttle him with a few dirty pesos. Hello, what's this about Jenkins?" His eye had caught the name of the man he wished to see in a column of local news, as he read, "Rutherford W. Jenkins came down from Las Vegas yesterday and is stopping at the Metropolitan." His face shone with satisfaction. "Good luck," he thought. "We'll be in Albuquerque in half an hour, and I'll go for my man like a steer on the prod." At the hotel, he found Jenkins with a number of other men smoking and talking on the porch. He did not expect to be remembered, for they had met only once, months before. But Jenkins came forward with his hand outstretched in greeting. "How do you do, Mr. Conrad? You don't get up to this part of the territory very often, but we're always glad to see you." "Thank you, Mr. Jenkins. I've come this time especially to see you, and as soon as you have a moment or two to spare, I'd like a private conversation." "Certainly, with pleasure. Just excuse me for a minute, will you, till I finish up the business I have with these men, and then we'll go up to my room." Conrad waited, tense and expectant. The quite apparent fact that Jenkins was engaged in mere desultory chat and storytelling increasing his irritation at the delay. He had jumped to the conclusion that Jenkins knew who Delafield was, and his breath came short and chokingly at the thought that in a few minutes he too would know. To know would be to act. His revolver was in his hip pocket, and he intended to go straight from the interview to that meeting which for half his years had been the one goal of his thought. He glanced at Jenkins, saying to himself, "He looks like a weasel, and I reckon he is just enough of one to have wormed around and worked this thing out." Jenkins was tall, slender, and slightly stooped, his face long and thin, with its salient features crowded too close together. "I reckon he knows all right," Conrad's thought went on, "and he'll tell me if I make the inducement big enough. He'll do anything for money." Under cover of the conversation, Jenkins had been doing his share of rapid thinking, prolonging the talk for that very purpose. He was putting together, with the acumen of a man in whom detective processes are a natural endowment, enough facts to convince him of the reason for Conrad's visit, considering the while just what he should do. He felt sure that he must expect a direct question about Delafield's identity, but he put off decision upon his response until he should hear the inquiry. "Now, Mr. Conrad, we'll go straight up to my room," he said cordially, laying a familiar hand upon the other's shoulder. Curtis shrank back a little, falling behind with a promptitude that left no doubt of his intention to keep the interview entirely formal. Jenkins licked his lips with an unwholesome smile and led the way in silence. As the door closed behind them, Conrad became aware of an increase of repugnance toward this man, so great that the necessity of dealing with him was an irritation. "Well, Mr. Conrad," said Jenkins cheerfully, giving the other no time to state his mission, "I hear you are putting in some good licks for Johnny Martinez down in Silverside. What do you think of his chances down there? Pretty good, aren't they?"
"Yes, I think so," Curtis replied curtly, and plunged into his own affair. "I have understood, Mr. Jenkins, from my friend Mr. Littleton of Chicago, whom you met last week, that you are interested in a matter of prime importance to me, and that you have some information I want to get hold of."
"Oh, yes. I remember meeting Littleton last week," Jenkins broke in. "A good fellow, too. So he's a friend of yours, is he?"
"Yes. He and I scraped up quite a friendship and had a good time together. But say, Conrad, the amount of throat varnish that man can stand is something amazing."
Curtis straightened himself in his chair impatiently. "He wrote me that he had some conversation with you about Sumner L. Delafield, formerly of Boston. But now I have reason to believe living here in New Mexico under an assumed name."
"Yes, I believe we did have a little talk about Delafield," Jenkins interrupted again. "But I'll have to confess," he went on jocularly, "that my mental condition wasn't perfectly clear, and it's likely my remarks were a little foggy, too. But I recall that we did have some conversation about the Delafield affair. Littleton had some personal interest in Delafield's failure, didn't he?"
"No. All the work he has done on the case has been for me.
I have considerable interest in it. Have you indeed? Now this is a coincidence. For some time past I've been a good deal interested in that matter myself. I suppose you were roped into some of his schemes? For a moment Curtis took counsel with himself upon what and how much he should say, only to thrust back his repulsion against saying anything at all to this man, and plunge frankly into his narrative. With the utmost brevity he told of his father's ruin, and of his own trailing of the culprit through so many years. Of his motives he said nothing, and of his work in tracking Delafield no more than was necessary. Few, even of his best friends, knew anything about the secret scheme of vengeance he had nursed from boyhood. Even Littleton, the detective who had aided him in the quest, did not know that he wanted to face Delafield for any reason other than to demand restitution. Having briefly outlined his story, Conrad went on to say that Littleton had led him to think that Jenkins must be engaged in the same search, and suggested that an exchange of their discoveries might be for their mutual benefit. Jenkins listened with evident interest, asking questions here and there concerning certain points in the other's long chase of the fugitive. "Yes, you've done very well, Conrad," he said, admiration in his voice. "Very well indeed. That was a damned crooked trail, and you've done a fine piece of work in following it through." Curtis gnawed his mustache and frowned. Jenkins's evasive speeches were increasing his irritation and repugnance almost beyond his control. "The amount of the matter is," he burst out, "I've got the notion that you know who Delafield is, and I'm willing to pay you for the information. I shall undoubtedly be able to find out for myself if I keep at it a little longer. But it happens that I want to know at once. If you know positively who he is, I am willing to pay you $300 for the knowledge." Jenkins walked to the window and stood there silently. He was weighing one thing against another and deciding whether he should tell the whole truth, a part of it, or none at all. Presently he said to himself that a bird in the hand today is worth a whole flock that may be in the bush tomorrow. "Before I decide about your offer, Mr. Conrad," he began cautiously, "there are but two or three things I would like to know. You are doing some good work for Martinez for Congress, I understand." "The best I can," answered Curtis with surprise. "Well, as you know, I am warmly in his favor myself. I want to get him the support of as many leading men in the territory as possible. This man Delafield is one of Baxter's influential lieutenants, and I particularly want to win him over to Martinez. You, I happen to know, have some influence with him." A nervous start betrayed the strain Conrad was under, and an eager look lighted his face. Jenkins saw it, smiled blandly, and inwardly decided to demand another $100. "It has occurred to me," he went on, "that you might be able to influence him when I couldn't. Combine this leverage with your friendship, and I believe almost anything is possible. If I let you have this information, will you agree to use it and your influence in such a way as to induce him to join in with Johnny Martinez?" The look that blazed in Conrad's eyes, coupled with the same involuntary shrinking movement that he had made in escaping Jenkins's hand at the foot of the stairway, showed the rapid ebbing of his self-control. Jenkins noticed both look and movement, and a gleam of angry resentment flashed into his dark eyes, but it was quickly repressed as he suavely asked, "Well, what do you say?"
"I don't know that I can promise," said Curtis stiffly, "that my influence would count as much as that. Possibly it will be enough to keep him from supporting Delmay Baxter. Yes," he went on with a grim look, "I think I can assure you that he will be neutral through the rest of this campaign."
"That might perhaps be satisfactory," said Jenkins meditatively, inwardly deciding to raise the price another $100 in lieu of the aid for Martinez. "But if that is all you're sure of doing, I shall have to ask more money for the information. It has cost me a great deal of time and effort, and if I can't bring about this result with it, I must repay myself some other way. I will tell you what you want to know, Mr. Conrad, if you will give me $500, and your promise to do your best to get him to support Martinez."
"That is what I said I could not do, and you are asking more money because I could not promise it."
"Well, then, if you will promise to induce him to remain neutral during this campaign."
"Yes, I will promise that, and I will give you the $500.
"Very well. It's a bargain." Curtis wrote his check for that sum on the First National Bank of Golden. Jenkins examined the bit of paper, folded it away in his pocketbook, rubbed his hands, and smiled at Conrad. "You will be surprised," he said, "when you hear the man's name. He is well known to you, and he is universally regarded all over New Mexico.
As a model citizen, as square and honest as any man in the territory, and much more so than most of them.
Yes, said Conrad, rising and reaching for his hat.
Yes, you will be astonished, I promise you, Jenkins went on, rising and facing Curtis, still smiling and rubbing his hands together in satisfaction.
For Sumner L. Delafield, the fugitive from justice, he began speaking slowly and impressively, the absconding defaulter, the man who sank the fortunes of hundreds of people, the man who had to hide in Canada and slink around in out-of-the-way places for so many years, is now known as... There was a brief pause to give his revelation its fullest dramatic effect. Is now known in New Mexico as Alexander Bancroft, president of the bank on which your check is drawn.
Conrad started, and his attitude of eager attention stiffened. For an instant, half a dozen Jenkinses seemed to be whirling about the room. Out of the repugnance, contempt, and anger boiling in his veins shot a definite idea, the desire to choke the man who had said this thing about his best friend. He leaped forward, seized Jenkins by the collar, and shook him as if he had been a 10-year-old boy. Although his arms were flying hither and yon, Jenkins grabbed wildly for the pistol in his pocket. Curtis saw the movement, and with his left hand seized the butt. As he pulled it out, Jenkins caught its barrel, but with a twist of his right arm and a jerk with his left, Conrad wrested the gun from the other's hand and threw it under the bed. His face white and his eyes blazing, he grasped Jenkins by the shoulders and jammed him against the wall until the windows rattled. With two quick backward strides he gained the door. Opening it with a hand stretched behind him, Curtis spoke with deliberate emphasis, pointing his words with a menacing forefinger.
Rutherford Jenkins, you're the damnedest liar and vilest skunk that ever made tracks in New Mexico. And if you ever tell that lie about Bancroft to another living soul, I'll wring your neck.
Jenkins sprang toward the door, but as it closed from without, he stooped, shook himself together, and swore under his breath. He took out the check and chuckled. I'll get it cashed before he changes his mind, he thought. Then a wave of anger and resentment rolled over him, and he shook an impotent fist at the closed door. Damn him, he said aloud. I'll get even with him yet. End of chapters 2 and 3.
Chapter 4 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 4. The Powers Confer. Lucy Bancroft bade a smiling goodbye to her father at the door of the First National Bank and crossed the street to a store on the corner opposite. Lingering in the doorway for her turn to be waited upon, she watched him with admiring eyes. What a handsome man Daddy is, she was thinking. I like a man to be tall and straight and broad-shouldered. And I'm glad he's always so well-groomed. I'd love him just as much if he wasn't, but I couldn't be quite so proud of him. Another man was coming up the street toward her father, and Lucy smiled as her eyes fell upon him. There's Congressman Baxter, her thought ran on. How slouchy and dumpy he seems beside Daddy. They say he's one of the smartest men in the territory, but I'm sure Daddy is just as smart as he is. And he's certainly a great deal handsomer and nicer looking. And he's just as nice as he looks, too, my dear Daddy. Bancroft appeared the man of substance and of consequence, confident alike in himself and in the regard of the community, as he stood in the door of his bank and met the congressman with friendly greeting. Glad to see you, Baxter. Come in. I want to have a talk with you. Delmay Baxter shook hands cordially, pleasure at the meeting fairly radiating from his round, sunburned face, even his cold gray eyes borrowing warmth from his gratified and shining countenance. One of these eyes was set at an angle, slightly oblique, its peculiarity made more prominent by the loose hanging of the upper lid from the outer corner. The expression of cunning thus given to the upper part of his face was curiously at variance with his jovial look and manner. In Bancroft's private office, Baxter's first question was if the other had yet visited the mine at the base of Mangan's Peak, concerning which they had had correspondence.
Yes, I was there this week. The man who owns it hasn't sabe enough about mines to know what a good proposition he's got. He'll sell cheap for cash, for he needs the money. I think it's a first-class investment, and we better snap it up. Shall we make it half and half?
I don't know about going in as a partner, Alec. I'm getting too much tied up with all kinds of enterprises, and I don't want to have more on my hands than I can attend to. But if it's a good thing, I'd like to help you get hold of it. I know you'd hustle its development and make all there is in it tell for the reputation of New Mexico. I've got too many other things on hand to go in as a partner, but if you haven't the ready cash to buy it yourself, I'll advance you what you need and take a mortgage on the property.
In the persuasive tones of Bancroft's reply, there was no hint of the reluctance and disappointment he inwardly felt at this prospect of having to increase his indebtedness to Baxter, concerning which he already felt some anxiety.
That hardly seems fair, Del. You gave me the hint about the mine, and you ought to make more than that out of it.
I'm satisfied it's an almighty good proposition and can be made to pay for itself and for the money needed in initial development inside the first year.
Oh, that's all right, Baxter responded heartily. I'm glad to let the chance come your way because you've got more savvy and more hustle than any other man I know, and you'll do something worthwhile with it. Think about it, and we'll talk it over again before I go back. I'm down here now mainly for politics. You know Silverside County as well as any man in it. How do things look?
Well, it's always a close county, you know. But you'll probably get the delegates to the convention, and I reckon you'll stand as good a chance on election day as Johnny Martinez.
The other chuckled. Well, I rather guess. Why, he's got no money to put into the fight.
No, but there are the Castletons.
I heard that their superintendent at Socorro Springs Ranch, what's his name, Conrad, had come out strong in his favor. What do they care about it? Neither one of them spends 2 weeks out of the year in the territory.
Oh, if they really have any interest in it, I suppose it's that everlasting cousin business of the Mexicans. You know Ned Castleton married a first cousin of Johnny's, although she's half American.
Baxter looked thoughtful. If he's got the Castleton money back of him, he began doubtfully, but broke off with an opposing idea. I've heard that the wives of the two brothers fight each other to the limit on every proposition that comes along, and I reckon if Turner's wife found out that Ned's wife wanted Martinez boosted into Congress, she'd see to it that Turner blocked the game if he could. If Ned Castleton should back up Martinez with a bagful or two of his loose cash, it would make mighty hard sledding for us, observed Bancroft. Baxter pursed his lips and whistled softly.
I reckon it would, he said with an air of taking the other into his innermost counsels. Then he broke out warmly,
That was damn good of you, Alec, to come out for me as squarely as you did in the Albuquerque Leader the other day. It's a good thing for me all over the territory to have people know that Alexander Bancroft is supporting me. They've got confidence in you, Alec. I appreciate it, I tell you, and I won't forget it either.
Baxter had already served 2 terms in Congress, and some members of his party thought he should be willing to stand aside and give someone else the prize. This made him anxious about the outcome of the approaching convention, and set him to interrogating the banker regarding the intentions of this, that, and the other man of local consequence. At last he came back to the subject of the Castletons.
Do you really think, Alec, that Ned Castleton's money is behind Martinez? If it is, that would explain Conrad's attitude.
Bancroft saw that the congressman was worried by the possibility of such effective opposition. On the instant, an idea was projected into his mind, born of his own secret anxiety and his knowledge of Baxter's reputation. It came so suddenly and so vividly that it took him unawares, sending a telltale light into his eyes and across his usually impassive countenance. His lids were quickly lowered, but Baxter had already seen the revealing flash and was wondering what it might mean. The banker hesitated for a moment, his thoughts confused by the force of the bolt which had shot into his mind.
"Of course, I don't know anything about it," he went on cautiously, the other watching him for signs of self-betrayal. "But it looks to me as if Conrad might be acting as Ned Castleton's agent, so that Ned won't have to be mixed up in it. That would take away the chance of Mrs. Turner's trying to make her husband block the game. And Conrad is violently opposed to you. He handles you without gloves, and is doing all he can against your nomination. He says he'll bolt you if you get it, and that if the other side puts up Martinez, he'll jump in and fight for him with both feet and his spurs on."
A smile faded from Baxter's face, and his left eyelid drooped lower than usual, a sign that his mind was busy with some knotty problem. But he was not considering the pros and cons of the Castleton money.
He was wondering why that sudden purpose had flashed in Bancroft's eyes, why he had shown that momentary discomposure,
and why he was now dwelling so much more strongly on the fact of Conrad's opposition.
He drew his chair nearer, and in confidential tones began to inquire about the young cattleman. "Has Conrad got much influence?"
"Yes, a good deal. He's a bright, energetic fellow, and he's made lots of friends."
"Know anything about him, Alec?"
"Not much.
Ned Castleton ran across him in San Francisco, I believe, where he was agent for one of the big cattle ranches in Southern California. He's been there as superintendent at Socorro Springs for 2 years, and he's put the ranch in better shape and made it pay better, in spite of the drought, than anybody else they've had since their father died."
"But where'd he come from before Castleton got him?"
"I don't know, except in a general way. I guess he's mostly run along with the cattle business in Colorado and California and New Mexico."
"Do you really think his opposition to me down here is important?"
"There's no doubt about it, Del," Bancroft rejoined, his manner becoming more earnest and his tones more persuasive as he went on. "Curt Conrad is a fighter from the word go, and he seems to have started out with the intention of doing you up. He'll sure do you a lot of damage if you can't find some way of making him change his mind. He's popular, the sort that everybody likes, you know, and he's always enthusiastic and cocksure, so that he has a good deal of influence of his own, whether or not he's acting for Ned Castleton. And as people generally believe he is, it amounts to the same thing."
"We must get at him some way," said Baxter earnestly, his cold eyes watchful of his companion's manner and expression. "Hasn't he done something that would give us a hold on him?"
"No, there's nothing in that lead. I've tried argument, and you might as well talk to a cyclone."
"How about money?"
Bancroft shook his head decisively. "That would be the worst mistake you could make. He wouldn't touch it, and he'd roar about it everywhere. The fact is, Del, we'll have to get rid of his opposition some way. I've done everything I can, and now I'll have to put it up to you."
"Well, I'll think it over," said Baxter, rising and looking at his watch. "I'll see you again about that mine business while I'm here. And I want to talk with you about a paisano ranch up above Socorro there's a chance of our getting. I think we'll be able to get our development company going in less than a year. When it's organized, Alec, I want you to be the president of it."
"I don't know about that," Bancroft replied slowly, an uneasy recollection of some of Lucy's freely expressed ideas coming into his mind. "I may prefer to stay in the background as a silent partner, as our arrangement is now."
"It would be good for the company to have you at its head. Your reputation would be an asset," Baxter objected persuasively.
"By the way, Del, did you foreclose on a man named Melgares, Jose Maria Melgares, a month or two ago?"
"Melgares, yes. And I was especially easy on him, let him have 3 months extra time, but I had to come down on him finally. Why?"
"He's here in Golden now, and he's been roaring about it. He came down here from the McGollins, where it's likely he'd been doing some horse stealing, and I guess he's been lifting chickens and things out of people's backyards since he's been here."
"Next thing, he'll be getting arrested," Baxter chuckled, "and I'll have to defend him. For nothing. These greasers all seem to think I'm a heaven-sent protector for 'em all, no matter what they do. So long, Alec. I'll see you again before I leave town."
Baxter lounged down the street, greeting one acquaintance after another with a jovial laugh, a hearty handshake, or a slap on the shoulder, his round, red face aglow with good fellowship. But his gray eyes were cold and preoccupied. At the courthouse door, he stopped to talk with Dan Tillinghurst, the sheriff, and little Jack Wilder, his deputy.
"Say, Jack," said the sheriff as the congressman went on up the street, "what sort of hell do you all reckon Del Baxter's cooking up now? He's too jolly not to have something on hand. The louder he laughs, the more sulfur you can bet he's got in his pockets."
"Be careful, Dan," warned Jack, "or that nomination for sheriff will misfire."
"Don't you worry about that. Del and me's all right.
You all just worry about the fellow that's made his eyes look like a dead fish's. Del's sure got something on his mind."
There was something on Baxter's mind. He was still wondering why Alexander Bancroft had insisted so strongly upon the importance of young Conrad's opposition, which the congressman did not believe was of much consequence. He chuckled, and his left lid drooped lower as he finally decided, "I reckon he wants me to pull some chestnut or other out of the fire for him. I'll just let him think I'm taking it all in. I'd like to know what it is, though, for if I don't keep a good hold on Alec, he's likely to get heady and try to step into my shoes."
End of chapter 4.
Chapter 5 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 5. Chastisement Condign. Dan Tillinghurst and little Jack Wilder sat under the big cottonwood in front of the courthouse, commenting upon things in general, and presently, more particularly, upon Curtis Conrad and his mare, Brown Betty, when they espied him talking with the landlord in front of the hotel across the stream. The town of Golden lay in a gulch among the foothills. It had been a thriving silver camp in the older days. Discovered in the heyday of the pale metal, it had yielded so richly that the men flocking thither, in sheer, exultant contempt of the value of its yellow brother, had named the camp Golden Gulch. The mines had been in the bottom of the gulch, and near them, along the banks of the stream, had been built all the houses of the mining days. The earliest roads had run along each side of the water, and these were still the main streets of the town. Facing one another across the two streets and the bed of the creek were all the public buildings and business houses, the two hotels, some of the best residences, and many of the poorer ones. The Mexican quarter, called Dobie Town by the Americans, straggled along these thoroughfares and up the hillsides, just beyond the heart of the town. Down their entire length, cottonwoods of notable girth and majesty spread their branches. One of the largest and finest of these trees shaded the courthouse corner, where the sheriff and his deputy were sprawling their legs and waiting for something to happen. The sheriff was burly and broad-shouldered, although his legs had not quite been able to keep pace with the growing massiveness of his torso. The occasions were rare when his blue eyes were not twinkling with good humor, while his mouth beneath its absurd little mustache curved in a smile as habitual as his cheerful kindliness and universal optimism. Little Jack Wilder, who owed his descriptive title to his 6'3" of height, was slender and lithe. He wasted neither words in talk nor bullets in pistol fights, and he had the reputation of being one of the best shots in the Southwest. As good even as Emerson Meade over at Las Plumas in the adjoining county. Curtis Conrad walked across the bridge that spanned the stream, Brown Betty at his heels, and met their "Hello, Curt," with "Hello, anything new?" "Yes," said Wilder, "anywhere there's likely to be." "What sort?" "That's what we'd like to know," said Tillinghurst. "Jack's been sashaying around Dobie Town for the last 2 days with his eye on a Mexican horse thief, waiting for him to do something he can be arrested for. And the darn fool won't do a thing. He just sits around respectable and behaves himself. Jack's getting all out of patience with him." Little Jack growled a corroborative oath and took a chew of tobacco. "Well, if you know he's a horse thief, why don't you arrest him?" asked Conrad. "We know it all right," said Jack, "but he ain't lifted no critters yet in this county. He's been doing some chicken thieving and that sort of thing around town the last week, but we ain't going to arrest him for that." Wilder shut his jaws with a determined snap, while Tillinghurst went on to explain in answer to Conrad's look of surprise, "If we arrest him for that, he'd be taken before a justice of the peace. And you all know what kind of a mess Diego Vigil would make of it. He'd likely fine the man whose chicken coop had been raided because he didn't have more stuff in his backyard to be stolen. And he'd discharge Jose Maria Megares with a warning not to wake people up o' nights by letting the chickens squawk." The sheriff's smile broadened and ran down his throat in a chuckle. Little Jack Wilder burst explosively into brief and profane speech that showed his opinion of Mexicans, and especially of Mexican justices of the peace, to be most contemptuous. "Then why do you give them the office?" Curtis demanded. "Both parties do it all over the territory, though you all know that every time they get a chance, they make justice look like a bob-tailed horse. Up north last week, one of them fined a man $5 for committing murder and warned him not to do it again or he'd have to make it 10 next time. You folks all knew what you might expect from Vigil when you gave him the place." "Oh, well, Curt, you all ain't run for office yet. When you do, you'll appreciate the fact that the greasers have got to be put where they'll do the most good. I'm willing to give them that much, and I'm only too thankful old Vigil and his friends don't strike for the sheriff's place." Tillinghurst chuckled, while Wilder smiled grimly and profanely reckoned he wouldn't serve under Vigil or any other Mexican.
Maybe that pockmarked Melgares has been up to some mischief by this time," he added. "I ain't set eyes on him for nigh 2 hours. Let's go down to the Blue Front, have a drink, and find out if anything's happened."
They went down the street together, Brown Betty following with the bridle over her neck. A block farther downstream, a good-looking Mexican came out of the First National Bank and passed them. The sheriff turned a second keen glance upon him. "That looks like Liberato Herrera," he said to his deputy in a hasty aside. Raising his voice, he accosted the man in Spanish. The Mexican turned and replied in precise English, with grave courtesy, "Did the señor speak to me?"
"Yes. Ain't you Liberato Herrera?"
"No, señor. My name is José González."
The sheriff apologized, and the other bowed politely, fell behind, and crossed to the other side of the stream. Conrad asked Tillinghurst if he did not believe Herrera guilty of the murder of which he had been acquitted several months before.
"Of course he was, and it's likely that ain't the only one either. I'm glad this man ain't him. If he was down here, it would be on some business for Baxter, and it wouldn't do for me to find out too much about it."
Conrad snorted contemptuously, and Wilder said, "Dan, you're talking too damn much."
"Oh, Kurt's all right," replied the sheriff placidly. "He couldn't hate Baxter any more than he does if he tried. But he don't go back on his friends. This man Melgares," he went on, "that we're hoping will make up his mind to do something worthwhile, tells a queer yarn. He says he used to have a good ranch in the Rio Grande Valley, between Socorro and Albuquerque, but he borrowed money on it from Baxter. Of course he couldn't pay, Del foreclosed, and Melgares had to get out."
"Yes, I heard the other day about Baxter's operations up there," Conrad broke in hotly. "I understand he's got hold of a lot of land in just that way. It's a cursed, low-down, dirty piece of business."
"Oh, well, better men than Baxter have done the same sort of thing," the sheriff responded. "From all I can find out about Magares, I reckon he was honest enough up to that time, but he's been going it pretty lively ever since. I think he's aiming to work down to the border, where he can do the crisscross act."
Conrad turned with an exclamation of sudden remembrance. "By the way, Bill Williams told me just now that Rutherford Jenkins is here, at his hotel. Have you seen him? Do you know what he's here for?"
"I haven't talked with him, but I reckon he's here on some deal for Johnny Martinez."
Curtis tied the mare to the hitching post on the corner. "I've heard," he said cautiously, "that he has a venomous tongue and uses it recklessly. Do you know whether he's been doing any outrageous talking lately?"
"Well, I reckon nobody would believe anything Jenkins said, anyway. But I haven't heard anything. Have you, Jack?"
Some other men came along, and they all stopped to talk together. Curtis leaned against the mare and stroked her glossy neck. She poked her nose into his coat pocket and found a lump of sugar, which she ate with much dainty tossing of her head. It was some minutes before they entered the saloon. The Blue Front has a two-roomed shanty on the edge of the Mexican Quarter. Gambling games of various sorts occupied the back room, and there, too, political deals were arranged and votes bargained and paid for between the American politicians and the leaders of the Mexicans. When Conrad and his friends came down the street, a number of men were in the rear room, some talking and others busy at cards. At a table near a side window, men of both races were engaged in a poker game. One of the players, a pock-marked Mexican with a defective eye, frequently glanced down the street. When he saw the sheriff and his two companions approach, he rose and watched them. The others wanted to know what he was looking at, and he asked who was the man with the brown mare. A tall, dark American with slightly stooping shoulders looked up with interest as he heard them give Conrad's name, and joined the group at the window. Several of the men spoke with enthusiasm about Brown Betty, and one, who said he had once worked at Socorro Springs Ranch, told them that Conrad thought more of her than of anything else he owned. When the men in front entered the saloon, the pockmarked Mexican cashed in his chips and slipped out through the rear door. The sound of Conrad's voice in the barroom caught the attention of the tall, dark American. An angry flush reddened his face, his beady eyes snapped, and the tip of his tongue licked his lips. Then something amusing seemed to occur to him, for his features relaxed into a smile, and he glanced briskly around the room. "See if you can find Melgares, will you?" he asked the Mexican with whom he had been talking. "Tell him I'll wait for him outside the back door." He stepped out into the bright sunshine, smiling and rubbing his hands together. Back of the shanty was a high adobe wall surrounding the corral of the Mexican houses fronting on the next street. A wooden door in the wall opened cautiously, and the pockmarked face looked out.
"You sent for me, Senor Jenkins?" the Mexican asked.
"Yes, it's all right. You needn't be afraid. I want you to do something, Melgares." They stepped inside the corral, and Melgares bolted the door.
"You saw Conrad's mare just now?" Jenkins began. "Fine creature, isn't she?"
"Splendid, senor. The finest I have seen in a long time."
"I'll warrant it. I never saw a better myself. Looks like a good traveler, doesn't she?"
"Si, senor."
"And a stayer, too, I guess. It wouldn't be hard to get to the Mexican border on her back, would it?"
Melgares grinned, then shook his head.
"But my family. I could not take them with me."
"Well, see here, Melgares. Here's $50. If you'll get away with Conrad's mare, you can have it for your trouble. It will take your family down there all right."
"But you, senor, where do you come in?"
He looked suspiciously at Jenkins.
"Oh, never mind me. Conrad did me a bad turn a while ago, and I'm evening up the score. That's all I want out of it."
"But now, senor?"
"Yes, now's your chance. He's in the saloon, and the mare's tied at the corner. The sheriff is in there, too. The risk is great."
"Well, I'll go in and keep them busy. I'll raise excitement enough inside so that nobody will even look out the windows. Get out there in 5 minutes and be quick about it, and ride off down the valley road."
"Give me the money, senor. I'll take the chance."
Jenkins returned and entered the bar room with his former companion without attracting the attention of Conrad and his friends. The other spoke of the report about the Castleton money and mentioned Curtis Conrad's name. Jenkins raised his voice in angry reply.
"Oh, damn Conrad. Martinez don't want his help."
Curtis heard the words and turned sharply around, his face flushing. Jenkins appeared not to see him and went on.
"The Castletons are all right, but Conrad's help would be a disgrace to any party. Martinez don't want it."
His voice rang loud and shrill above the silence that had fallen suddenly upon the room. Curtis's face paled even under its ruddy tan, and his eyes blazed. With head up, he strode forward.
"Jenkins," he said without raising his voice, though it shook with a warning tremor, "I advise you to be careful. You may have your opinion about me as I have mine about you, and you know what that is, but don't you say that again, nor anything else of the sort."
Jenkins turned toward him with an ugly sneer. Recollection of former indignities at Conrad's tongue and hands blazed up in his heart and carried him farther than he had meant to go. With an oath and a vile name, he flung his glass in Conrad's face. In an instant, the young man's arms were around his body. The others crowded in and tried to stop the quarrel.
"Let us alone," shouted Curtis, pushing his way toward the back room. "Wilder, take his gun, will you? Get mine out of my pocket, too. This won't be a gun play."
Tillinghurst took Conrad's pistol, and Wilder succeeded in getting Jenkins's revolver, at the cost of a kick on the shin, which he repaid in kind. With Jenkins almost helpless in his grasp, Curtis struggled into the rear room. The others were all crowding after him. He turned back a face still pale and set with anger, although a twinkle of amusement was creeping into his eyes.
"Dan," he called, "shut that door and keep out the crowd."
Instantly there were cries of disapproval.
"Fair play. You're bigger than him. We want to see it's on the square."
Curtis scowled. "If any of you think it won't be on the square, just wait for me till I get through with him," he shouted. The sheriff slammed the door and set his bulk against it, saying with smiling cheerfulness, "Well, gentlemen, I reckon Mr. Jenkins won't get any more than is coming to him, and as sheriff I call on all of you to keep the peace and not interfere." Alone in the back room with his prisoner, Conrad dropped into a chair, dragged the other over his knees, face downward, then threw out one sinewy leg and caught it under Jenkins's two unruly limbs. Still keeping a firm grip with his left arm, he raised his right hand.
"Now," he said grimly, "you're going to get the sort of spanking your mother didn't give you enough of."
One after another of the resounding smacks came down, while Jenkins, his strength spent in futile struggle, could do nothing but writhe helplessly under the smarting blows. The sound of them penetrated to the front room. As the men there realized what was happening, they broke into laughter so uproarious that it smote upon Jenkins's ears and forced a hysterical shriek from between his gritted teeth. In Conrad's heart it inspired compassion, and he desisted.
"I guess that'll do for this time," he said, releasing his hold and standing the culprit on his feet. "I don't want to have to hurt you. But let me tell you, you damned skunk," and he seized Jenkins's shoulders and gave him a vigorous shake, "if you ever dare talk about me again in that way, or tell another human being what you told me about Bancroft, I'll make you wish you'd never been born." With a parting shake, he let Jenkins fall back into the chair, sobbing aloud. Then he stalked to the door, not even doing his enemy the slight honor of going out backward. End of chapter 5. Chapter 6 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 6. A Stern Chase. As the shout which greeted Conrad's entrance died away, the sheriff called out, "Now, gentlemen, you must all have one with me." And everyone lined up at the bar. A rollicking din of chaff and laughter filled the room, and no one except little Jack Wilder noticed the entrance of a Mexican at the street door. He heard the step, turned quickly, and recognized the man who had told Tillinghurst that he was not Liberato Herrera. Glancing along the line of backs at the bar, the Mexican singled out Conrad and touched his arm. "I beg your pardon, senor, but did you send someone to ride your mare?"
"To ride my mare? No. What do you mean?"
Before he could answer, Wilder sprang forward, demanding, "Is she gone?" And Conrad started for the door.
"A man has just ridden her away on the run," the Mexican said excitedly, and everyone in the room rushed for the street.
"She's gone," shouted Conrad. "Did you see him? What was he like?" demanded the sheriff.
"A pockmarked greaser with a bad eye?" yelled Wilder, towering threateningly above the bearer of the news.
Gonzalez threw back his head, folded his arms across his breast, and answered deliberately, "He was a Mexican, senor. He was pockmarked, and he was blind in one eye."
"Melgares! He's done it again, at last! Hooray!" shouted Wilder.
Far down the street, beyond the last cottonwood, against the gray, sun-flooded road, they could see a dark object, distorted by the heat haze, but still showing the form of a man on a galloping horse. Tillinghurst's smile became an eager grin as he started up the street on a run.
"Everybody come that wants to," he called over his shoulder.
Wilder and Conrad were already half a block ahead of him, and several others quickly followed. When they presently came pelting back, their horses at top speed, a crowd of men still stood on the sidewalk, where the blue front made a splash of brilliant color against the somber grays and browns of the surrounding adobes. Wilder's tall, thin figure was in the lead, bending forward in the saddle like a sapling in a gale, the wide, limp brim of his sombrero flapping in the wind. Conrad and Tillinghurst were pressing him close, and half a dozen others were pounding along behind these three, while a stout man, who rode awkwardly, trailed along in the rear. The crowd at the blue front shouted encouragingly as they clattered past and made bets on the chances of catching the fugitive. The Mexican, Gonzalez, watched Conrad closely as he sped by, and said carelessly to the man beside him, "Señor Conrad is a good rider, the best of them all. I hope he will get back his fine mare." The horsemen swept down the street past the last straggling houses and out into the open plain. Fleeing down the road, perhaps 2 miles ahead of them, galloped the Mexican. Tillinghurst measured the distance with a careful eye and said to Conrad, "He's our meat. We can get him easy." He glanced backward, chuckled, then turned in his saddle and called loudly, "Come along there, Pendy. Don't get discouraged." Another of the party turned his head and yelled, "You're all right, Pendy. You'll get there before Dan does." The stout man who brought up the rear had made sure of his gray slouch hat by tying it on with a red bandana handkerchief. He was gripping his bridle with both hands and bouncing in his saddle like a bag of meal.
"Don't you worry about me," he yelled back good-naturedly. "You can't lose me if you try."
"Who is he?" asked Curtis.
"Pendy?
Oh, he's a tenderfoot. Blew in from the east 2 or 3 weeks ago. Something wrong with his bellows, or likely to be, though you all wouldn't think it, considering his fat. He's grit clear through, though. Just look at the way he rides."
Conrad glanced back, laughed, and replied, "Oh, it'll be good for his liver."
Then he went on seriously, "Dan, do you think there's any truth in the story that this man Melgares began horse-stealing because Del Baxter did him out of his ranch?"
Oh, I don't know. Baxter got his ranch all right, but the greaser didn't have to go to stealing horses on that account. Chickens are safer, and chilies don't even squawk. I reckon likely he steals horses because he'd rather. Well, anyway, Dan, all I want out of this is to get Brown Betty back. I shall not make any complaint against him, so if he gives up the mare, I'd rather you let him go.
Ha! Grunted the sheriff, with an apprehensive glance at Wilder, a full length ahead.
For God's sake, Curt, don't let Jack hear you say that. He'd be so disgusted he'd turn tail and go straight back to Golden.
The fugitive kept his distance well. It seemed to Conrad's eye that he even gained a little. Now and again they could see him look back, and with spur and quirt, urge the mare to a fresh burst of speed.
"Brown Betty's a stayer," said Curtis, bringing his horse beside Tellinghurst's again, "and she's fast. I don't believe we'll catch him unless something happens to her."
The sheriff turned a smiling face and said confidently, "If we get a little nearer, I reckon something's likely to happen to him."
"Hello, Pendleton," he exclaimed as the stout man came up on the other side. "That noble steed of yours is sure getting a gait on him, ain't he? If you all don't wait for the rest of us, there'll be trouble, I'm telling you."
"Say, Sheriff," called Pendleton between his gasps and grunts as he bounced up and down, "are you going to keep up this pace all day?"
Tillinghurst eyed him benignly.
"As long as he does," he said, nodding toward the fleeing spot of black down the road.
"Say, Pendy," he went on in a kindly tone, "it's a pretty stiff gait for you all, and unless you're anxious to take your meal standing up for the next month, you'd better drop out and go back. It's likely to be an all-day job."
"Not much. You can't lose me till the fun's over."
"Hooray for Pendy. He's all right," yelled a man behind, giving Pendleton's horse a sharp cut across the flank with his whip. The beast jumped, and its rider lurched to one side, fell forward, and saved himself by grabbing the mane with both hands. The men shouted with merriment as Pendleton righted himself, turned a laughing face, and shook his fist at the man who had played the joke on him.
"Just wait till I get you where I want you, Jack Gaines," he called, "and you'll be sorry you ever played tricks on a tenderfoot."
The gulch spread out into a wide, shallow valley, a draw, they called it, and the waters of the stream disappeared, sucked up by the thirsty earth. The valley curved to the east, the road climbing over its rim and holding straight toward the south. The figure of Melgares, mounted on Brown Betty as on a pedestal, stood out boldly for a moment against the turquoise sky as he crossed the summit, then sank out of sight beyond the hill. The party galloped on, and as they crossed the ridge and saw him on the top of a smaller hill beyond, Conrad's eye swept the distance lying between, and he exclaimed, "We've gained on him!"
At the same moment, little Jack Wilder, who had been watching the road intently, shouted joyously the first words he had spoken since leaving the town, "She's cast a shoe! Now it's a cinch!"
Tillinghurst turned his head and shouted, "Get your gun ready, Pendy! Your chance is coming!"
Jack Gaines, riding neck and neck with the sheriff, looked back and yelled, "Come a-runnin', Pendy! The greaser can't wait for you all day!"
They were gaining rapidly on Melgares, and as they swept over the top of a little hill and saw him cross the next low rise, Conrad exclaimed, "She's limping, damn him! If he hurts Brown Betty—"
"You won't mind so much if we hurt him," quietly put in the sheriff, who was riding on his lee.
Curtis spurred his horse to Wilder's stirrup.
"Jack," he said, "I don't want the fellow hurt. If he'll give up my mare, I'm willing to let him go."
Little Jack grunted contemptuously without replying.
"I want you to understand," Conrad went on, "that if you take him, I shall make no complaint against him, provided I get Betty unhurt."
"You don't have to make no complaint," Jack growled. "I'll do that myself."
They gained steadily on the fugitive, and presently Curtis curved his hands about his mouth and called, "Betty! Betty B!" They could see the mare check her speed, and the faint sound of her whinny reached their ears. Conrad called again, and the mare wheeled in her tracks. The Mexican jerked her back, lashed her furiously, and set her forward again at a gallop. Curtis called again and again, and every time they could see Melgares using whip and spur to force her on. But presently the mare dropped tail and head, arched her back, and stiff-legged began to jump up and down.
Conrad laughed joyously and slapped his thigh. "Bully for Betty B. I never knew her to buck before."
They urged on their horses and pounded down the hill toward the small circus Brown Betty was making of herself. She cavorted, shook herself, humped her back,
jumped up and down, stood on her front feet, and almost sat on her tail, and did everything that equine intelligence could devise to rid herself of the masterful hand on her bridle. But the Mexican kept his seat and his grip upon the rein. With spur and quirt and compelling voice, he finally forced her into submission. As she quieted down, they were facing the pursuing posse, and Melgares had just turned the mare's head in another desperate attempt at escape, when Conrad's voice rang out once more, and Brown Betty refused to move. She tossed her head, laid back her ears, and whinnied, but would not lift a hoof. The Mexican drew his revolver and shouted, "Stop!" The horsemen, not more than 100 yards distant, drew rein at the word, all except Pendleton, who came pounding and bouncing to the front, his horse still on the gallop. Gaines, just behind Tillinghurst and Wilder, called out laughingly, "Hooray for Pendy! Go on and get him, Pendy!" Pendleton had been too much occupied with keeping his seat to try to stop his horse, and as it went on half a length in advance of the rest, Gaines leaned forward and gave it a cut across the flank with his quirt. It leaped forward smartly, and Pendleton, taken unawares again, bobbed down on its neck and grabbed for its mane. Melgares saw the horse start forward, and instantly his revolver flashed. The bullet left a singed streak across the back of Pendleton's coat, whistled on, and found refuge in Gaines's side. Wilder's gun was out and cocked. He saw Pendleton lying on his horse's neck and heard Gaines cry out, "I'm hit!" as he fell forward across his pommel. "Stop that!" he called. "Fire again and you're a dead man!" Melgares leaped from the mare's back and ran at full speed down the valley, away from the road. Brown Betty came trotting to Conrad's side, whinnying joyfully. Pendleton sat upright, calling out, "Say, fellows, is there any blood on my back?" They told him no, and as he climbed down from his saddle clumsily, he grinned and said, "Well, I can still die of consumption, then." Tillinghurst, Wilder, and several of the others were galloping after Melgares, who was running for his life down the valley toward a clump of cactus and juniper. "Wing him, Jack," called the sheriff. "There's a crack in the ground down there where he can hide and pick us off as he pleases." Little Jack brought his horse to a sudden stop, aimed low, and the Mexican reeled and fell, the blood gushing from a wound in the calf of his leg. He scrambled to his feet and fired his second shot. The bullet nicked the brim of the sheriff's hat. There was another flash, and Wilder heard the bullet sing past his ear. "Stop it, you damned greaser," he yelled, "or I'll let daylight through your head." In quick succession, he put two holes through the Mexican's sombrero. "The next one is for your other eye," he called, and Melgares dropped his weapon. Wilder leaped to the ground and ran toward him. He glanced at the group of horsemen, each with revolver drawn, and at Wilder coming with his gun at cock, and threw back his head with his own pistol at his temple. Little Jack grabbed his arm, but Melgares fought desperately. The others came running to Wilder's assistance, and it was not until they had taken his revolver, put handcuffs upon him, and taken from his clothing another pistol, a knife, and a belt full of cartridges, that he gave up his struggles. They put him on the horse that Conrad had ridden, with his feet tied under its belly. Tillinghurst and Wilder, revolvers in hand, rode on either side of him. Conrad, mounted on his own mare, and another were side by side with Jack Gaines, laid across their laps. Two more went on at a gallop to bring out a doctor and a carriage for the wounded man. The rest rode slowly back through the hot sunlight and the high wind, guarding their captive and carrying his victim. End of chapter 6. Chapter 7, Part A of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 7, Part A. Talk of Many Things. Golden prided itself upon being the most American town in the territory, but for all its energy and progressiveness, it had not developed an ordinary regard for its own safety. After the mines which had given it birth had been worked out, it became the depot of supplies for the widespread miles of cattle country in the plains below, the mining regions in the mountains above, and the ranches scattered along the streams within a radius of 50 miles. As its importance increased, a railway sought it out. The honor of being the county seat came to it, and the ruthless Anglo-Saxon arrived in such numbers, and so energetically, that its few contented and improvident Mexicans, thrust to one side, sank into hopeless nonentity.
when Lucy Bancroft first set upon it the pleased eyes of youthful interest and filial affection, it was a busy, prosperous place of several thousand souls. But it still clung to the gulch wherein had been the beginning of its life and fortune. All the houses of its infancy had been built along the stream that sparkled down from the mountains. And there the town had tried to stay, regardless of the floods that occasionally swept down the canyon during the summer rains. At first its growth had been up and down the creek. Afterward, cross streets had been extended far out on either side, especially where gradual hill slopes gave easy grades, and roads had also been made lengthwise along the hillsides and even on their crests, where now a goodly number of homes looked out over the plains and down upon the town-filled valley at their feet. Newcomers gazed curiously at the high sidewalks raised on posts above the level of the thoroughfares, asking why, if there was such a possibility of flood, the people continued to live and do business along the bottom of the gulch. The residents thought the walled sidewalks rather a good joke, a humorous distinction, and laughed at the idea of danger. Lucy Bancroft's eyes grew wide and solemn as she listened to the tale Dan Tillinghurst told her of the first year he was in Golden, years before, when a mighty torrent roared down the gulch, carried away most of the houses, and drowned a dozen souls. But the very next day, he added proudly, the people began rebuilding their houses on the identical sites from which they had been swept. "Why didn't they rebuild on higher ground?" Lucy asked. "And aren't you afraid there will be another flood that will destroy all these houses, and perhaps kill a great many people?" "Oh, there's no danger now," he assured her confidently. "The climate's changing. There's not nearly so much rain as there used to be. The creek is dry half the time nowadays, and in my first years here it never went dry at all. Just look at these flood marks." And he pointed out to her on the side of the brick building that housed her father's bank, the lines to which had risen the high waters of each summer. She saw that those of recent years were all very low. "Yes," he assured her, "the climate's changing. There's no doubt of that. There won't be any more floods." Between Lucy and the sheriff a mutual admiration and good fellowship had arisen, such as might exist between an elephant and a robin. The day after her arrival, Tillinghurst had told Bancroft that his daughter was the prettiest piece of dry goods that had ever come to Golden, and if he ever let her pull her freight, he'd sure deserve nothing less than tarring and feathering at the hands of an outraged community. Notwithstanding her confidence in the big sheriff, Lucy did not like the idea of living in the gulch, and persuaded her father to build their home on the brow of the mesa, overlooking the town from the west. She had no definite fear of the floods, nor, after her first few weeks in the place, did she so much as think of danger from such a source. She liked the site on the mesa, although it was new and raw and treeless, because it commanded a far-reaching view to the mountains on the west and north and in front, across the town and the valley to the wide gray level of the plains. She sat on the veranda of her new home with Miss Louise Dent, telling her friend what pleasure she was taking in its arrangement and direction. "At first Daddy didn't want me to do it. He thought it would be too much care and responsibility for me, and that we'd better board. But I said if a girl 18 years old wasn't old enough and big enough to begin to take care of her father, she never would be. And so he gave up. And now, well, you'll see how he enjoys our home. He just beams with happiness every time he comes into the house. And I'm perfectly happy. Daddy is so good, and it's such a pleasure to make things nice and comfortable for him." "I'm so glad," Miss Dent replied, "that you are happy here with him. He has had so many years of lonely wandering, and I know that he has long been looking forward to the time when you and he could have a home together. Your father hasn't had an easy life, dear. You could never guess all that he has been through, but he is a strong and determined man, and he's finally won success, just as I always knew he would. That's what I admire in him so much, that he never would give up." She stopped, a faint flush mounting to her brow. Lucy threw both arms around her neck and kissed her. "Of course, dearie," she exclaimed. "You must appreciate my father, for you've known him so long. But it makes me love you all the more to hear you say so. And, oh, dearie, I'm going to make such a beautiful home out of this place." Lucy looked about, her girlish face glowing with proud and pleased proprietorship. "I know how new and barren it looks now, but just wait till I've been at work at it for a year." She went on to speak of her plans, asking Miss Dent's advice. In the backyard, the gaunt wings of a big windmill gave a touch of ultra-modern picturesqueness and promised the fulfillment of the girl's hope
of a lawn and flowers, trees and shrubbery, in the near future. While a deep veranda ran halfway across the eastern front and around the other two sides, the neutral gray-green color of the structure melted into the hue of the hills and the surrounding mesa, leaving its barren newness less aggressive. As they talked, Lucy now and then cast a lingering glance down the street that climbed the hill from the town below, and Miss Dent thought that sometimes a shade of disappointment dimmed the bright face for an instant. She was 20 years Lucy's senior, although both looks and manner gave the lie to the fact. The loving friendship between them was one of those unusual ties between a younger and an older woman which, when they do occur, are apt to be marked by an overflowing measure of enthusiasm and loyalty. Louise Dent had been the intimate friend of Lucy's mother, and after her death had given the bereaved girl such love and care and sympathy as had won her instant and ardent devotion, and the relationship thus established had grown stronger and closer as the years passed and Lucy matured into womanhood. The girl's enthusiastic affection had enabled her to find in Louise Dent intimate friend, elder sister, and mother combined. This complicated feeling, making it impossible for her to address the elder woman by either formal title or first name, she had soon settled upon Dearie as a substantive term expressing their relationship, and Dearie Miss Dent had been to her ever since, whether between themselves or among her own intimate friends. As the shadows grew longer and the hot white sunlight became less vivid, Lucy seemed to grow restless. She rose and moved about the veranda or ran down into the yard and back upon some trivial errand, each time stopping on the steps to send an inquiring eye down the street. Standing there, when the afternoon was far spent and the fierce westerly wind had ebbed into a gentle breeze, she pointed out to Louise the statuesque sapphire mass of Mangan's Peak against the turquoise blue of the eastern sky, and told her of the drive thither and back she and her father had taken a fortnight before, and of their call at Socorro Springs Ranch. "It's an interesting place," she went on. "Such a huge ranch. Why, its grazing rights extend more than 100 miles south, away across the Mexican border. Father knows the superintendent very well, and we'll get him to drive us out there some day." A high color rose in her cheeks. She quickly turned away, drew her chair well back, and sat down. "There's Mr. Conrad, the superintendent, coming up the hill now," she exclaimed. "Daddy told me at luncheon that he was in town." Lucy bore her new role of hostess with a dignity so easy and gracious that it surprised Louise, and made Conrad think her more attractive than ever. Bancroft came a little later, and Curtis was urged to stay to dinner. Lucy showed him in her conservatory the collection of cactus plants she had begun to make, and listened with eager interest while he gave her information about the growth of the species she already had, and told her where she could find others less common. She was anxious to have his opinion whether it would be possible to make a hedge of mesquite to replace the wooden paling around the yard. He did not know, but offered to help her try the experiment. They dined on the side veranda, where Lucy, with the help of a screen or two and some plants from her greenhouse, had contrived an out-of-doors dining room. The high spirits of the two younger people dominated the conversation as they jested and bantered, laughed, and crossed wits in little wordy sword plays that called forth applause and encouragement from the others. Lucy sparkled and dimpled, and her color rose, while Curtis's eyes darkened and flashed. Miss Dent, watching them, realized what an attractive young woman Lucy had grown to be, and how much she had blossomed out even in the few months since their last parting. "She will have plenty of admirers," the older woman thought, with a little twinge at her heart. Still, she was very young, and it would be a long time yet before she would think of marriage. But if she were to marry and leave her father, he would be very lonely, perhaps. And then she felt her cheeks grow warmer, and hastened to resume her part in the conversation. Louise was pleased with Conrad's face. It seemed full of character, with its broad brow, tanned cheeks, large nose, and well-set chin. She noted especially the strong, firm jaw and chin, saying to herself that they betokened the strength of will and constancy of purpose that foretold success in whatever he might undertake. He was amusing them with an account of the feud between the wives of the Castleton brothers. "But don't the men take up the quarrels of their wives," Louise asked, "or allow any feeling to come between them?"
Not in the least, nor does there seem to be any ill feeling between the ladies. They are always good friends, and the men look upon the whole thing as a good joke. If Mrs. Turner, for instance, cooks up some new scheme for getting the better of Mrs. Ned, she tells her husband about it, he tells Ned, and they laugh over it and make bets about which will win. Lucy was interested in the Castleton ladies. Conrad said that Mrs. Turner Castleton was considered a great beauty, but that he liked Mrs. Ned, who was half Mexican, much the better, and thought her the more interesting and charming. She asked if they ever visited the ranch. "Yes," said Curtis. "Ned and his wife come up for a few days every spring. This year they'll be there after the roundup is over and the cattle shipped. Would you like to meet them?" "All right, we'll arrange it. While they are there, I'll get up a barbecue and a baile, and ask some people. You and Miss Dent and your father must all come." The American in the Southwest, arrogant and contemptuous as the Anglo-Saxon always is when brought face to face with a difference in race, a difference in ideals, or a difference in speech, regards the Spanish language with frank disdain and ordinarily refuses to learn it. But where the Mexicans are present in large numbers, as in New Mexico, he adopts from the other's language a good many words which soon supplant their English equivalents. An evening party of any sort, whether a public dance in the town hall, a select affair in the house of a prominent resident, or a gathering in the Mexican quarter, is always a baile, a thriftless, insignificant person of either race, a paisano, while upon coyote, the American has seized with ready tongue, applying it to any creature, human or other, for which he wishes to express supreme contempt. Miss Dent had to have a baile explained to her, and their talk drifted to the subject of the Mexican people. Bancroft told her the story of the bold theft of Conrad's mare, the chase and capture of Melgares, and the wounding of Gaines. "It is thought that poor Jack cannot live," he said in conclusion, "and the Mexican is held in jail to await the result. If he dies, the fellow will be tried for murder." "I've heard a queer story about Melgares," said Conrad, and went on to tell how the Mexican had lost his little ranch. Lucy listened attentively, with indignant eyes fixed on Curtis's face. "How shameful!" she broke out. "What a detestable way of getting money! The poor Mexicans, just think of their being turned out of their homes in that way, with nothing to fall back on. I don't wonder poor Melgares became a thief, but he ought to have gone to Santa Fe and stolen Mr. Baxter's horses." End of Chapter 7, Part A. Chapter 8, Part B of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 8, Part B. Specters of the Past. Bancroft rose and looked at his watch. "If there's anything of particular interest or importance in this, Mr. Jenkins, I'll be very glad to listen to it some other time, but I can't stay any longer this morning. I ought to have been at my desk half an hour ago." Jenkins sat still and waved him back with insistent politeness. "One moment there, Mr. Bancroft, if you please. I'm coming to the point right away. This story is of some consequence to me, and I'd like to know if you can verify it. Have another drink." Bancroft swallowed the whiskey at a gulp, and Jenkins noticed that his fingers trembled as he took the glass. He was thinking, "I'd better stay and find out exactly how much he knows." Jenkins smiled under his hand as he smoothed his straggling mustache and watched Bancroft wipe the sweat from his forehead. "This man Smith," Jenkins continued, "John was his name too, John Smith and John Mason Hardy, were partners in a mining enterprise down in Mexico. One of them died down there, died, you know, in a quiet, private sort of way, and the one that came up to the States again was named Hardy, but it wasn't the same Hardy that had gone down there. You might guess, if you wanted to, that Smith killed Hardy and took his name." He stopped and drew back suddenly, for Bancroft had sprung forward with a white, angry face and was shaking a trembling fist under his nose. "Stop there, you liar!" he exclaimed in low, tense tones. "I didn't do that. He died a natural death, of fever, and I took care of him and did my best to save his life." Jenkins recovered his self-possession first. "Oh, then you know all about it," he said dryly, with a malicious smile. Bancroft sank back in his chair, drawing his hand across his eyes, and wondering why his self-control had so suddenly gone to pieces. He had thought himself proof against any surprise, but this man's sudden blow and persistent baiting
had screwed his nerve tension to the snapping point, but he told himself that it probably did not matter anyway, as Jenkins evidently knew the whole story. With a desperate, defiant look, he turned upon his tormentor. "Well, what do you want?" he demanded sharply. "Why have you raked up this old story?" "Oh, I found it interesting," Jenkins responded in a leisurely way, "as an instance of the way things are done on the frontier, and, as I told you at first, I thought you might be able to verify it, for I was inclined not to believe it, especially as it was about one of the most prominent and respected citizens of New Mexico. But since you've confessed its truth yourself, well, I've got to believe it now. It has been a very blind trail I've followed, crooked and well hidden, wonderfully well hidden, Mr. Bancroft, and the number of names you've hoisted along its course has been bewildering, but I've managed to track you through 'em all, and to discover in Alexander Bancroft the upright, honored, public-spirited citizen of New Mexico, the identical person of Sumner L. Delafield, the defaulting and absconding financier of Boston." Bancroft looked Jenkins sullenly in the eye. "Well, now that you have it all, what are you going to do about it?" "Pardon me, Mr. Bancroft," said Jenkins with exaggerated suavity. Mr. Delafield, that is for you to say." The banker considered for a moment only. Evidently this man knew exactly what he was about and exactly what he wanted, so that it would be of no use to beat around the bush. "Will you please say precisely what you mean?" was his answer. "That is just what I have been doing, Mr. Delafield." "Excuse me, Jenkins, but my name is Bancroft, not Delafield. I have a legal right to the name of Bancroft given me by the legislature of Arizona. You will oblige me by addressing me in that way." "Oh, yes, I know that, and a lot of trouble I had with this chase until I found it out. But I thought you might like to hear yourself called Delafield once more, sort of like meeting an old friend, you know. Won't you have another cigar, Mr. Bancroft?" "No? Well, then let's have another drink." He poured out two glasses of whiskey. Bancroft drank his without demur, but Jenkins barely touched his glass to his lips. "Well now, Mr. Bancroft," Jenkins went on affably, smiling and rubbing his hands together, "let's get down to the practical side of this romantic story from real life. You are getting on so well here under your present name, and you have a young daughter." He saw his listener wince at this, and then carefully repeated his word, "and you have such a beautiful and charming young daughter, who, as the heiress of a father who is making a fortune with clean hands and no cloud on his past, can be taken about the world and can make a good marriage some of these days. Considering all this, I take it for granted that you would prefer to have this story buried too deep for resurrection, and it is for you to say whether it shall be buried or not." Bancroft sat in silence for a full minute, glaring at the man opposite, his lips set in a livid line. Jenkins grew nervous in the dead stillness of the room, and began to fidget. He cautiously rested his right hand on the bed close by his pistol pocket, and kept his eyes on the banker, watchful for the first hostile movement. There was need of wariness, for Bancroft was debating with himself whether it would be better to go on to the dreary end of this business and leave the room with a blackmailer's noose around his neck, or to whip out his gun, put a bullet through this man's brain and another through his own. But the fragrance of life rose sweet to his nostrils, and his innate virility spurred him on to keep up the fight. Apparently he had brought up against a stone wall, but he had fought too long and too desperately to be willing to confess himself beaten until he could struggle no longer. He felt sure that money would keep Jenkins quiet, and after a while he might find some other means of stopping the man's mouth for good. The fellow was always in some dirty job or other, and before long doubtless some hold on him would become possible. There was Conrad still to be reckoned with, but that could wait, at least until this man was silenced. "Well," he said quietly, "what do you want? For God's sake, come to the point." Jenkins drew a breath of relief. "Well, Mr. Bancroft, I'm interested this year in the success of Johnny Martinez. It's a matter of the first importance to me for him to be elected, but I'm afraid he hasn't got much chance if Silverside County and the rest of the South should go against him. Now, you've got more influence down here than anybody else, and you can swing it for him if you want to. That's what I want you to do." Bancroft looked up in sudden dismay. He had not expected anything of this sort. "You know I'm committed to Baxter," he said. "Oh, yes, I know. But that's nothing. In New Mexico, it's not difficult to change your politics. Why, I thought of coming out for Baxter myself at first, but I'm solid for Martinez now."
Bancroft rose and began pacing the half-dozen steps to and fro that the room afforded, seeking some loophole of escape from his obligations to Baxter. There were mortgages the congressman could foreclose that would balk some of the banker's most promising plans should he attempt political treachery. He could, and undoubtedly would, reveal his associate's connection with the loan and mortgage operations in the Rio Grande Valley, and Bancroft winced as he thought of this coming to Lucy's ears. And in that matter of Curtis Conrad and Jose Gonzalez, had he not put himself at Baxter's mercy? In this moment of supreme necessity, the naked truth came before him, and he knew it to be true that he was primarily responsible for any harm that might come to the young cattleman through Gonzalez. If he did not keep faith with Baxter, the congressman would tell Curtis who it was that desired his death. And then Conrad would know where to find Delafield. In short, he knew that Baxter would stop at nothing to compel his loyalty or punish his treason. Having contemplated no course except that of fidelity in his business and political relations with Baxter, the closeness of their alliance had heretofore given him little uneasiness, and now, in this crisis, he found himself wholly in the other's power. He flung himself into his chair, his face pallid, and the perspiration standing in great drops on his forehead. His breath came hard, and his voice was thick as he asked, "Is there no alternative?" "Well, no, none that I can accept," Jenkins replied meditatively. "You see, it's a very important matter for me to be able to make this present to Johnny. If he wins this fight, there'll be something big in it for me. No, I'll have to insist upon this as the first condition." Bancroft's lips moved soundlessly as he stared at the man sitting on the edge of the bed, nursing his knee and showing his white teeth in a triumphant smile. Then suddenly, without a word of warning, the banker leaped forward and seized his companion around the throat. Jenkins, taken entirely off his guard, succeeded only in grasping his assailant's coat as they went down on the bed together in a noiseless scuffle. Bancroft's hands closed around his tormentor's throat, and a savage elemental satisfaction thrilled in him and goaded him on. More and more tightly his fingers clutched as Jenkins struggled under his grip. Neither of them uttered a sound, and the silence of the room was broken only by the creaking of the bed or the occasional knocking of a foot against the chair. Bancroft's face was snarled like that of a wild beast as he watched Jenkins's visage grow livid and his struggles weaken. Of a sudden, reason returned to him. If this man were to die under his hand, there would be gruesome consequences, and he had enough to deal with already. He stood up, trembling, and looked anxiously at the still form on the bed. You're not dead, Jenkins, are you? He stammered awkwardly. Jenkins stirred a little, opened his eyes, put his hand to his throat, and got up, looking warily at his assailant. "It's no thanks to you that I'm not," he responded sullenly. "I didn't mean to kill you, but you struck me too hard. It drove me wild, and for a minute I didn't know what I was doing." Jenkins scowled, rubbed his throat again, and drank a glass of whiskey. Bancroft helped himself likewise, following it with a copious draught of water. As they faced each other again, Jenkins edged away suspiciously toward the door. But Bancroft went back at once to the unsettled question. "It would ruin me, financially and in every other way, to go back on Baxter. You might just as well kill me outright as insist upon that." "But I'm going to insist upon it," was Jenkins's sullen answer. Bancroft made a despairing gesture. "But I tell you, Jenkins, the thing's impossible. It would ruin me just as surely as for you to tell all you know. You'll have to be satisfied with something else." Jenkins leaned against the bed and stared angrily at Bancroft. Physical pain had made him obstinate and determined him to press his point, more to return injury for injury than because he wanted that particular thing. "I tell you now," Bancroft went on, "that I'd rather take the last way out than try to go back on Baxter. It wouldn't be the healthiest thing in the world for you if I should kill myself, shut up in this room with you, would it?" "Well, I'll waive that for the present," Jenkins replied unwillingly. "But mind you, it's only for the present. We'll talk about it again later in the season. For the present, I want a good big sum before you leave this room, and hereafter I've got to have a regular monthly payment, a check on the first of every month when I don't come after the cash myself." Bancroft considered for only a moment. His dilemma was clear. He must either buy this haltered freedom from Jenkins or kill him in his tracks. This latter alternative was not to be considered. and doubtless before long it would be possible to turn the tables on the creature and escape from his clutches. Jenkins folded away in his pocketbook a check and a roll of bills and smiled as he looked at Bancroft's haggard face. "I hope, Mr. Bancroft, that I have not kept you too long from your affairs at the bank." As his eyes followed the banker's disappearing figure with a gleam of satisfaction, he patted his breast pocket and whispered, "Now for the other score." End of Chapter 8, Part B. Chapter 9 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 9. Perils in the Night. Red Jack and Jose Gonzalez joined the forces of the Socorro Springs Ranch while the cattle of the morning's roundup were being driven to the watering place near the ranch house. Across the road from the house stood a large grove of cottonwoods. A little beyond that, in the valley, a deep pond had been dug, into which flowed the outlets from the several springs. The cattle from a score of miles round about were accustomed to come to this pond, with its circling belt of trees, for water and for midday rest in the shade. Here the roundup was in progress, and Conrad galloped out to meet the new hand and give him instructions. As he rode off toward the hills after a bunch of straggling cattle, Curtis looked after him with an approving eye. "He knows how to fork a horse, at least," he thought. In the afternoon, Jose was set to work cutting out and bunching the 2- and 3-year-old steers, and later at helping with the branding. Conrad watched his handling of the branding irons, and he and all the rest stopped their work to follow his movements with critical eyes as he roped and brought to the ground a belligerent steer. The superintendent was well satisfied. "At last I've got a man who knows the business and has some sabe," he thought. "If he goes on as well as he begins, I'll keep him after the shipping is done." The next day the roundup crept slowly southward, accompanied by the chuck wagon and a drove of fresh horses. At noon the cattle gathered during the morning were bunched at Adobe Springs, the next watering place toward the Mexican border. Gonzalez was the only Mexican among the cowboys, the rest being Americans of one sort or another, from Texas, Colorado, the Northwest, and the Middle West. All felt toward him the contemptuous scorn born of difference in race and consequent conviction of superior merit. They had no scruples about making known their prejudice, and more than once his face flushed and his hand darted toward the knife hidden in his bosom. Yet, as the day wore on, and they saw that he excelled the best of them in handling the lasso and in the cunning of his movements when cutting out the steers from the herd, they began to show him the respect that skill of any sort inspires in those who know with what effort it is acquired. After supper, when they gathered about the campfire, smoking and scoffing good-naturedly at one another's tales of wondrous experiences, and talking over the events of the day just gone, they received him upon an equality with themselves which was only slightly grudged. He told them, in English more precise than any of them could speak, of Conrad's encounter with Rutherford Jenkins in the Blue Front, and their appreciation of the tale completed the work which his skill as a cowboy had begun. Thereafter they looked upon Jose as a comrade and a good fellow. 3 small adobe houses, of 1 room each, with flat roofs and earthen floors, had been built here, as the large and never-failing springs made the spot a sure rendezvous for every roundup. The locality was infested by skunks, and the cowboys, who greatly feared midnight bites from the prowling animals, believing hydrophobia a sure consequence, usually preferred to sleep inside the houses, on bunks filled with alfalfa hay. If they ventured to sleep out of doors, they kept small cans of coal oil ready, and, whenever a wakeful man saw one of the small creatures near, a quick turn of the wrist drenched its fur with the fluid, and a brand from the smoldering campfire tossed after it sent a squealing pillar of flame flying up the hill and saved them from further disturbance that night. A board nailed across a corner of the largest house served Conrad as a desk. He kept there a lamp, writing materials, and a few books. While the men sprawled around the campfire and the last gleams of dusky red faded from the west, and the moon bounded up from behind the eastern hills, he made his memoranda, wrote a letter to be sent to the post office by the first chance comer, and lost himself for an hour in a volume of Shakespeare. When he went outside, the men were walking about, yawning and stretching, ready for sleep. Curtis's imagination was still astir from his reading,
and the presence of any other human being seemed an impertinence, but he said genially, "Well, boys, you begin to look as if you wanted to turn in. Take whatever bunks you like if you want to go inside. I'm going to sleep out here." "Better have a tin of ale handy," said Red Jack. "The polecats are sure likely to nibble your toes if you don't. The night I slept here last week, I never saw the cusses so bad. Durned if one of the critters didn't get inside and wake me up smelling of my ear. I was some scared of him stinking up the place so it couldn't be slept in for a year, so I just had to lay low and wait for him to go outside. And then I doused him good with ile and throwed the candle at him. I sure reckon he's holed up somewhere now, waiting till he can afford a new sealskin sack before he shows himself in good society again." "I don't think they'll bother me tonight," Curtis responded. At that moment he felt that nothing could disturb him if only he could be left alone with the moonlight and the plain. "I'll sleep with my boots on, and my cheeks are not as fat as yours, Jack, so there'll be no temptation. Where do you want to bunk, Jose? You can sleep outside or in, just as you like." Gonzalez replied respectfully that he would rather go in, but presently he came out again with his blanket and chose a spot against the wall of one of the houses. Conrad had gone out to the herd to speak with the man on patrol and to make sure that all was well. When he returned, the men had disappeared. "Good," he said to himself. "They've all gone inside, and I've got the universe to myself." He did not see the still form in its gray blanket close against the wall. Curtis took the red bandana from his neck and tied it over his ears, to keep out the tiny things that crawl o' nights, and couched himself in his blanket on the gently rising ground, with his saddle for a pillow. He lay down with his face to the east, where the dim and mellow sky, flooded with moonlight, seemed to recede far back, to the very limits of space, and leave the huge white globe suspended there in brooding majesty just above the plain. With long legs outstretched and muscles relaxed, he lay as still as if asleep, his eyes on its glowing disk. He knew all that science had discovered or guessed about the moon's character and history, but it had companioned him on so many a silent ride across long miles of dimly gleaming plain, and on so many nights like this as he lay upon the earth it had gathered his thoughts into its great white bosom, that he could not image it to himself as a mere dead and barren satellite of the earth. More easily could he understand how the living Cynthia had once leaped earthward and been welcomed with belief and love. Conrad's mind busied itself at first with the play he had just been reading, but presently wandered to his own affairs and the purpose that had been the dominant influence of half his life. He chuckled softly as he remembered the check he had recently received. "I've got him on the run," he thought, "and I'm bound to lay him out sooner or later. Lord, but it will be a satisfaction to face him finally. And he'll not get the drop on me first, either, unless Providence takes as good care of rascals as they say it does of fools." He recalled himself now and then to listen to the sounds from the sleeping herd, to the hoofbeats of the horse as the cowboy on watch rode round and round the bunch, and to his voice singing in a lulling monotone. But gradually thought and will and sense sank back toward the verge of that great gulf out of which they spring. When next he opened his eyes, the moon was dropping toward the western horizon, but he had turned in his sleep, and its light was still upon his face. Lying motionless, Curtis listened to the sounds from the herd, his first thought being that something unusual there must have awakened him. The coyotes were yelping at one another from hill and plain, but through their barking he could hear the snorting sigh of a steer turning in its sleep, the tramp of the horse, and the cowboy's lullaby. He recognized the voice of that of Peters, who was to have the third watch, and so knew that it must be well on toward morning. He was about to sink into slumber again when his gaze fell upon a small black and white animal nosing among some rocks nearby. "Poor little devil, if it wakens any of the boys it will get a taste of hell out of proportion to its sins," he thought, and decided that he would drive it away before anyone else discovered it. But the languor of sleep still held him, and not a muscle moved as his eyelids began to droop. Then, through his half-shut eyes, he became conscious that something was moving, over against one of the houses, among the shadows. His eyelids lifted again, and he saw the Mexican rise out of his blanket, look about, and in a crouching posture move stealthily toward him. Something in his hand glittered in the moonlight. "It's Jose," thought Conrad. "He's coming for the skunk with a can of oil. Quick, or I'll be too late." He sprang to a sitting posture and flung out one arm. As he did so, he noticed with sleepy surprise that Jose was not facing toward the animal, but was coming toward him. Then, before he had time to speak, the Mexican turned, a flying something shone in the moonlight like an electric flash, and Conrad's eyes, following the gleam, saw the little creature pinned to the ground with a long knife through its neck, and the gray sand darkening with its blood.
"Why, Jose, that was a wonderful throw!" he exclaimed.
"Yes, senor," the man replied quietly as he stooped to draw out the knife and wipe it on the sand. "I am rather good at that sort of thing." End of chapter 9.
Chapter 10 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 10. By a Hair's Breadth. Curtis Conrad rode to the farther side of a hill sloping gently northeast of the houses as the outfit was getting underway the next morning. He remembered having seen there a rather uncommon species of cactus, and he thought to make sure of it in order to secure a specimen for Lucy Bancroft's collection when next he should pass that way on a homeward trip. Jose Gonzalez noted his action, and presently, when a steer broke wildly from the herd and ran back, it was Jose who dashed after it. But instead of heading it off and driving it back, he so maneuvered that he contrived to get it around the hill behind which he had seen Conrad disappear. The superintendent was digging busily in the ground with his pocket knife, having decided to take up the plant and leave it in the house in readiness for his return journey. Assured that the rest of the outfit was out of sight beyond the hill, Gonzalez left the steer to its own devices and galloped straight toward and behind the kneeling figure, his long knife drawn but concealed against his leg. Conrad's attention was engrossed in what he was doing, and his thoughts were all of Lucy Bancroft, of how pleased she would be to get this rare specimen, and of how necessary it would be for him to help her plant it. Jose checked his horse into a walk and leaned forward, his eyes fastened on the other's back, his knife lying half hidden in his palm. On the soft ground, the hoofbeats of the horse made little sound, and their faint, unresounding thud was masked by the noises from the moving herd. Gonzalez drew rein within a few yards of his object and lifted his arm with the knife balanced in his hand. At that instant the steer bellowed, and Curtis leaped to his feet, on the alert at once lest something had gone wrong with the herd. He saw the single steer, and wheeling around to look for others, his glance took in the Mexican, swerving his horse down the hill and deftly returning the knife to his belt.
"Are you after the steer, Jose?" he called. "Is that the only one loose?"
"Yes, senor. The rest are all right. This one has given me a chase, but I'll have him back right away."
"Stop a minute, Jose. Would you mind letting me use your knife? Mine's too short, and I haven't anything else."
Gonzalez rode up, dismounted, and held out the knife with a courteous smile. As he stood back with one leg forward, arms folded, and head held high, Curtis thought him an image of dashing, picturesque, masculine comeliness.
"Jose," he said, "how did you get such skill in throwing the knife? I never saw anybody do the trick better than you did it last night. I shouldn't like to have you," and then he smiled as he returned the weapon, "aim this thing at me as you did at that polecat."
An answering smile flashed over Jose's dark face, lighting up his eyes and showing a row of white teeth beneath his mustache.
"I have practiced it much, senor. It is not easy."
The next day, Conrad, Gonzalez, and several others were getting together some cattle in the foothills, when three of the largest steers broke away and raced wildly back toward their grazing grounds. The superintendent called the Mexican to help him, and told the others to take the remainder of the cattle, with all they might find on the way, back to the day herd. Two gallant figures they made as they galloped across the plain, the wind blowing up the wide brims of their hats, the grace and freedom of strength and skill in every movement of body and limb. Lariats were at their saddle horns, and Curtis carried a six-shooter in his belt, but Gonzalez had only his knife, thrust into his bootleg. They circled and headed off the steers, which eluded and dashed past them again and again, until presently Conrad noticed that the largest of the three acted as a sort of leader.
"Rope him, Jose," he called, "and then we can manage the others."
As Gonzalez in response came galloping toward the animal from one side, Curtis rushed past it on the other to prevent it from getting away and giving another chase. He glanced at the loop that came whirring through the air, and his heart gave a bound of vexation.
"The fool greaser is throwing too far," he muttered.
With an instinct of sudden peril, he dug in his spurs, and his horse made a quick, long leap. He whirled about in time to see the snaky noose fall on the spot whence they had jumped. "What's the matter with you, Jose?" he shouted. "You nearly roped me instead of the steer. Try it again." Gonzales coiled his rope and galloped after the steer, and half an hour later the two men rode into the roundup, driving the panting and humbled animals. One of the younger and less experienced men, Billy Black, generally known as Billy Kidd, happened to lame his horse and bruise himself that day, and was ordered to stay in camp to nurse his knee. At Rock Springs, where they made camp next day, a man who gave his name as Andy Miller rode up and asked for a job. He explained that he had been working on a little ranch over toward Randall, but had got tired of the place and was pushing for the railroad. Hampered by Billy Black's accident, Conrad was glad of the opportunity and tested his skill with horse and rope. "You'll do," he said. "I'm short of hands, and you can stay with us until we get to the railroad, if you'd like." The new man was stockily built and looked strong and agile. Around the campfire that night he won his way at once into the good graces of the other men, cracking jokes, telling stories, and roaring out cowboy songs until bedtime. They were so hilarious that Conrad joined their circle, smoked his after-supper pipe with them, and laughed at Miller's jokes and yarns. The Rock Springs watering hole was in a hilly region, broken here and there by stony gulches. The outflow from the springs ran through a ravine which furrowed the hillside to its foot, turned abruptly westward, and widened out into a goodly pool, where the cattle waited and drank. The camp lay on the hillside above the springs, and the cattle were bunched over its brow on the other side. Conrad wakened early, and an inviting image came to him of that pool, lying still and clear in the dim gray light, untroubled by the miring hoofs of the cattle. No one else except the Chinese cook, busy with his breakfast fire, seemed to be awake, and no one stirred as Curtis moved down the hill, past the springs, and over the rise beyond. But Gonzales, motionless in his blanket, watched his departure, and presently, when the cook had disappeared in the chuck wagon, Jose rose, cast a cautious glance over the sleeping camp, and followed Conrad, taking advantage of occasional boulders, clumps of mesquite, greasewood, and yucca to conceal his movements. At the springs he turned down the gulch, following its course to the basin of the drinking hole, where he hid behind a great boulder, barely 10 feet from the bank where lay the other's clothing. With wary eyes he watched while the superintendent waded out to the deepest part of the pool, ducked and splashed, swam a little, and presently returned to the shore. Through the brightening air the lean and sinewy body with its swelling muscles gleamed like rose-tinted marble below the tanned face and neck. Behind the boulder, Jose crouched closer and drew the knife from his belt, while his body grew tense as he watched Conrad rub himself down and put on his clothes. "Will he never keep still a second?" Gonzales asked himself impatiently as he poised his knife. Curtis sat down on a flat stone and reached for his shoes and stockings, whistling a gay little melody from the last comic opera he had heard in San Francisco. A sound of shouting and the muffled noise of rushing cattle broke through the morning air, which had been as still and untroubled as the surface of the pool. Conrad, his music silenced and nerves alert, faced quickly toward the camp, turning his body from the waist upward and giving Gonzales a fair three-quarters view of his torso. The Mexican, ready and waiting, seized an instant of arrested motion and sent the poised weapon straight for his heart. As it left Jose's hand, the stone on which Curtis sat, yielding to the twisting motion of his body, slipped under him, and he threw out his left arm to preserve his balance. He was aware of something bright cleaving the air, of a sudden pain in his arm, and a stinging point in his side. But before his brain could realize what had happened, he saw Jose Gonzales leap from behind the boulder and rush toward him, befouling the air with a string of Spanish oaths. Conrad sprang to his feet and wheeled, with right fist ready to meet the attack, before Jose could reach him. The Mexican flew at him, with both arms outstretched, meaning to seize his throat and throttle him before he could comprehend his danger. Curtis saw the open guard and landed a blow on his chest, which sent him staggering backward, but he returned at once, with left arm raised in defense and right hand ready to seize the other's shirt collar and choke him senseless. For a moment only was Conrad at a disadvantage by reason of the suddenness of the assault, but with the knife still bedded in his bleeding and helpless left arm, his only weapon was his right fist, which he must use for both defense and attack. The Mexican's eyes were fired with the passion of combat, and the other, ignorant of why they were fighting, knew only by his blanched face and set jaws that his purpose was deadly. Gonzalez, after that first blow upon his chest, was wary. He danced around Conrad, making feints and trying to get inside his guard. But Curtis, whose brain was working in lightning-like flashes, did not waste his strength pounding the air. He kept his assailant eluding his feints and jumping to escape pretended charges, thinking to wear him out in that way. He soon saw that he was the superior in boxing skill, as well as being both taller and heavier than his foe, and he began to feel assured of final victory, notwithstanding his useless hand and disabled arm. Jose's effort was constantly toward Conrad's left side, and Curtis guessed that he was trying to get possession of the knife still sticking in his arm. He knew that if Gonzalez recovered that weapon, his chance of life would be small indeed. His bare feet were bleeding from the sharp little stones on the bank of the pool, but he was conscious neither of that nor of pain in arm or side, though the blood from his wound was making a red streak down his shirt and trousers. But he continued to hear, with a kind of divided consciousness, the sound of shouts, the rushing of cattle, and the hoofs of galloping horses. In the back of his brain he knew that there had been a stampede of the herd, and with attention absorbed in his fight for life, the thought that he was needed at the camp spurred him on to more desperate effort. Jose made a dash for his left side, but Curtis turned and with all his force sent a blow which caught the Mexican, intent on the knife, with shoulder unguarded. Gonzalez spun half round and reeled backward. Conrad had planted one foot on a rounding stone, and as he delivered the blow, it slipped and sent him headlong. He was up again in an instant, barely in time to save himself from Jose's fingers, which clutched at his throat. But Gonzalez had got inside his guard, and they gripped, the one with one arm and the other with two, for what each felt must be the final struggle. The American caught Jose's left arm between their two bodies, and reaching around him, grasped the other wrist in his right hand. They swayed back and forth, Jose exerting all the strength of his muscles to free his arms, while Conrad, gripping him close, used all the remnant of his strength to throw him down. By this time the Mexican's eyes were gleaming with an ugly light, and his olive cheeks were flushed with anger. Whatever the purpose that had moved him at first, Curtis saw that he was fighting now with the aboriginal rage of conflict, with the fierce hate born of the blows he had received. He kicked wildly at the superintendent's shins, and accidentally planted the heel of his boot squarely upon the other's bare foot. Conrad's face twitched with the hurt, and with a snarling grin, Gonzalez lifted the other for similar purpose, forgetting shrewd tactics of battle in the lust of giving pain to his opponent. But Curtis caught the momentary advantage of unstable balance, and with a twist and a lunge they came down together, Conrad's left shoulder striking against a stone beside which the Mexican fell. Thrilling with the surety of triumph, his enemy pinned to the ground, Curtis was barely conscious of a snapping in his shoulder and a sharp pain in his collarbone. With one knee on Gonzalez's chest, he pulled the knife from his left arm, broke it across the boulder, and threw the blood-stained pieces far out into the pond. His assailant was at his mercy now, and the heat and anger of combat ebbed from his veins as he looked down at the Mexican's unresisting figure. "You have bested me this time, Don Curtis," said Gonzalez quietly. "Get up, Jose," replied Conrad, rising, and the two men, panting from their conflict, faced each other. Jose stood with his arms folded and head erect, and looked at his employer with unafraid eyes, in which smoldered only the traces of his recent rage. Conrad surveyed him thoughtfully for a moment before he spoke. "Jose, what did you do it for?" The Mexican smiled but made no reply. "Have you got anything against me?" Conrad persisted. "Do you think I've mistreated you or injured you in any way?"
"No, senor, I have nothing against you."
"Then what? By God, are you one of Del Baxter's thugs? Has he sent you down here to stick me in the back?" Impelled by the flash of sudden conviction, Conrad thrust his face close to the other's and glared into his eyes. Gonzalez stepped back a pace and looked gravely across the hill at the reddening sky. His composed face and closely shut lips showed that he did not intend to answer. "Oh, all right," Curtis exclaimed. "I don't expect you to peach on your pal, but I reckon I've sure struck the right trail this time. And look here, Jose, was it me you were after when you stuck your knife in that skunk?" The Mexican's eyes fell and his black brows met in a frown. He was thinking how much trouble this man had given him by springing up so unexpectedly that night. but for that it would all have been so easy and simple. I reckon it was, Conrad went on hotly, and I reckon it was me instead of the steer you rode after the next morning with your knife ready when I looked up. And I reckon it was me instead of the steer you tried to rope when you made that remarkable miss. I've been a fool to trust a damned greaser, even when he was in plain sight. But look here, Jose Gonzalez. Conrad stopped and glared into the Mexican's somber and inscrutable eyes. Holding his bleeding left arm in his right hand, he leaned forward, head thrust out, and eyes blazing. Just you look here, Jose Gonzalez, he repeated. I'm on to your little game now. And if I can't be a match for any greaser that ever tried to stick a man in the back, I'll deserve all I'll get. Just come on and try it again whenever you like. Keep at work with the roundup if you want to. I'm not going to give you your time for this. But I am going to write to Del Baxter that I'm onto his scheme and that the minute you make another crack at me, there'll be a bullet in your brain, and another in his as soon as I get to Santa Fe to put it there, and that he'd better call you off if he wants to save his own skin. But if you can get me without my catching on first, you're welcome, that's all. The rush of running cattle swept across their preoccupied ears, and both men turned to see a dozen steers sweep past the other end of the pond and up the hill. Quick, Jose, help me head them off and turn them into the pond, Conrad exclaimed as he started off in his bare feet. His long strides covered the distance quickly, and with hoots and yells and waving arm he soon turned their course down the hillside toward the water. Gonzalez was close behind, and together they maneuvered the frightened beasts to the pond, where the animals forgot their panic, waded in quietly, and began to drink. Jose, said the superintendent, as he sat down at the water's edge and began to bathe his muddy, bleeding feet. I shall not mention this affair to anyone here. I'll say that a steer horned me just now. I've broken my collarbone, I think, and I've got this cut in my arm, and I'll have to go to Golden at once to get patched up. But when I come back, I want you to remember what I just told you about getting daylight through your skull if you try any of your tricks on me again. There comes Red Jack after these cattle. Go and help drive them back to camp. End of chapter 10. Chapter 11 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 11. Battling the Elements. The shadows of the little rolling hill still sprawled across the intervening valleys when Curtis Conrad started back at a gallop over the road which his outfit had been slowly traversing for 4 days. To his foreman, Hank Peters, he had said that he had been thrown and gored by a steer and must go to Golden to have his collarbone set, and ordered him to stay where he was, cutting out and branding that day and night, and camp the day after at 5 Cottonwoods, where he would rejoin them. The men puzzled and gossiped about the accident to their employer. I don't see how it was possible, said Peters, for such a thing to happen to a man that's got the boss's gumption about cow brutes. None of 'em was on the prod when I got to the pond, Red Jack declared. Jose, you was with him. Did you see the scrimmage? I did not see the boss when he was down, Gonzalez replied in his precise, slightly accented English. I was at the spring, and heard him yell, and I ran down to the pond at once, for I thought he needed help. I stumbled and fell and sprained my shoulder. It hurts me yet, so that when I reached the pond, he was on his feet again and trying to drive the cattle into the water. I helped him, and then we went back to where his shoes were. That was where Jack saw us. His arm bled a good deal there. Something happened, observed Hank Peters, and if the boss says it was a steer on the prod, I sure reckon it was. But the thing that's troubling me most is what started them critters off. I didn't see or hear a blamed thing likely to set 'em going. Did any of you? I didn't. Texas Bill spoke up. But Andy was there first. Did you see what it was, Andy? Andy Miller, the new hand, stopped to draw several deep whiffs from his newly lighted pipe before he replied. No, I couldn't make out anything, and I was right at the edge of 'em, too. They jumped and started all at once, as crazy as I ever see a bunch of critters. Maybe you scared 'em some, they not being used to you, suggested Billy Kidd. Andy grinned. Well, I sure ain't boastin' none about the beauty of my phiz, but no gal ain't told me yet that I was ugly enough to stampede a herd of cow brutes. And the subject was dropped with the laugh that followed. Conrad's mare,
larger and of better breed than the cow ponies, put the ground rapidly under her feet throughout the early morning. Though never trained for range work and used only for riding, he always took her on the roundup, in readiness for emergencies. His habit of talking to himself, engendered by much solitary riding, was often varied by one-sided conversations with the mare, and whatever the subject which occupied his thoughts and found fragmentary utterance in speech, his sentences were interspersed with frequent remarks to Brown Betty. Apparently she found this custom as companionable as he did, for she was sure to protest at a long period of silence. "So ho, my pretty brown bee," said Conrad gently, as he patted the mare's sleek neck. "That's the pace to give him." A sharp twinge in his shoulders set his lips together, and an oath, having Congressman Baxter as its objective, came from between his teeth. "I'll write that damned Baxter a letter," he broke out savagely, "that will singe his eyelashes when he reads it." His thoughts went back to the subject which so frequently occupied them, his lifelong vengeful quest of the man who had despoiled his father, wrought destruction upon their home, and changed the current of his own life. His heart waxed hot as he recalled his interview with Rutherford Jenkins. Never for an instant had he doubted that Jenkins's statement was a deliberate lie. Smiling grimly, he stroked the mare's mane. "I was a fool, wasn't I, Betty, to suppose I'd get straight goods out of him? It cost me $500 to find out that he's a skunk, which I knew before. I deserved all I got, didn't I, Betty, for not having more gumption?" The frontiersman's caution, which grows almost instinctive in one who rides much alone over plain and mountain, sent his eyes now and again to search the long stretch of road that trailed its faint gray band across the hills behind and before him, and to scan the sun-flooded reach from horizon to horizon. A red stain accentuated the meeting line of sky and plain in the west. "Betty Brown, do you see that red mark yonder?" he said, gently pulling her ear. "That means a sandstorm, and we've got to hike along at a pretty stiff pace while we can. What do you think about it, my lady?" The mare raised her head and gave a little snort. "Smell it, don't you?" he went on as he patted her approvingly. "Well, that's where you're smarter than I am, for I reckon I shan't be able to do that for another hour." He fell silent again, thinking of the Delafield matter and Jenkins's assertion that Bancroft was Delafield. "He sure knows who Delafield is," was his conclusion announced aloud, "but he's not going to tell. He's probably blackmailing the man, whoever he is, and he won't take any chances that would be likely to spoil his income. Well, that proves that Delafield is somebody in New Mexico rich enough and prominent enough to make it worthwhile for Jenkins to keep his knowledge to himself. I've got that much for my $500 anyway. Lord, Betty, wasn't I a tenderfoot?" And he swore under his breath, half angrily, half amusedly, as he turned again to study the road and the plain. The heat haze was rising, and the clear white sunlight was master of earth and sky. Far to one side he noted the silvery lake of a mirage, but the red line had mounted higher and become a low, dirty red wall that seemed to fence the western expanse from north to south. "It sure looks like a bad one, Betty, and I'm afraid we shan't be able to get home tonight after all. But we'll make Adobe Springs anyway, if it doesn't catch us too soon." The pain in his shoulder brought his mind back to the conviction that Baxter had instigated the assault upon him, and he began searching for the motive. Did the congressman think his political opposition important enough to make his taking off desirable? Suddenly, he slapped his thigh and broke out aloud. "Lord, what if Baxter should be Delafield? He sure ought to be if there's anything in the eternal fitness of things. If he should be, and he broke off with a hard, unmirthful laugh. Ransacking his memory for all he knew of Baxter's life, he presently shook his head regretfully. "No, the facts are against it. There's nothing in that lead. It's a pity, though, for it would be a satisfaction, to say nothing of the public benefit, to knock 'em both off the roost at one pop." His mind busied itself with conjectures about Delafield's identity, as he considered first one and then another of the more prominent men in the territory. He was silent so long that the mare tossed her head impatiently and whinnied. Curtis smiled and stroked her mane. "Hello, old girl," he said aloud. "Getting lonesome, are you? And you want to be talked to. Oh, you're spoiled, Betty B., that's what you are. We'll go up the hill and see Miss Bancroft, won't we, Betty, while we're in Golden, and we'll take that cactus to her and help her plant it. And she'll come out to the fence to see you, Betty,
and she'll give you a lump of sugar and pat your nose and look as sweet as a pink rose with brown velvet eyes. She's a bully fine girl, and we like her, don't we, Betty Brown? The way she sticks by her father is great. He couldn't help being a first-class fellow, could he, B.B., with such a daughter as that? The red wall was rising in the sky, devouring its sunlit blue and spreading out into smoky red, angry-looking clouds. A high wind, hot and dry, swept across the plain from the west. All the cattle within Conrad's range of vision had turned their heads to the east, and although they were still grazing, moved only in that direction. Seeing a herd of antelope headed the same way, Curtis took the red bandana from his neck and waved it toward them. As the bright signal floated in the wind, their leader turned, stared, and began to walk back, the whole herd following with raised heads and gaze fixed in fascinated interest. He flaunted the red square, and they came steadily on, until presently the warning of danger in the hot wind and the odor of the approaching storm overcame the compulsion of curiosity, and they wheeled again, away from the threatened peril. The small life of the plain was fleeing before the furnace-like breath of those red surging clouds. Jackrabbits leaped across the road on fleet legs, and occasionally Conrad saw coyotes, singly or in packs, running eastward as for their lives. Fat carrion crows hurried their unwieldy flight, and, higher in the air, a frequent lone hawk sailed out of the west, while now and then a roadrunner cut across his path with hasting feet. "It's going to be a bad one, I guess," Curtis muttered, jamming his soft hat down closer on his head. The mare seemed to be trying of her own accord to escape the storm, and her swinging lope was steadily leaving the miles behind. "Keep it up, Betty, keep it up," he said encouragingly. "I want to reach Adobe Springs and get this message to Baxter off my mind. My shoulder's aching, old girl, but it ain't aching a bit more than I am to tell him what I think of him." Soon the sandstorm was upon them, concealing the landscape and covering the sky with its clouds. Upon man and beast it beat as bitterly as a sandblast. It pelted and stung Conrad's face and neck, and filled his eyes and ears and nostrils until he was forced now and again to pull his hat over his face for a moment's respite in which to draw a less choking breath. "It looks as if all Arizona had got up and dusted, and was hell-bent to get out of here," he jested grimly, as he bent over the mare's neck and encouraged her with voice and gentle stroke. "That shows good sense, Betty, though it's mighty hard on us. Come right along, old girl. We must get to Adobe Springs." As the air grew thicker, there shone from the sky, instead of the vivid white sunshine of a few hours before, only a dim, diffused, lurid light. Even to Curtis, sitting quartering in the saddle, with his back twisted toward the wind, Brown Betty's ears were barely visible. For a while he allowed the mare to follow the road herself, until he found that her sense of duty must be supplemented by authority. For under the discomfort of the belaboring wind and stinging sand, she began to yield to her instinct to turn tail and drift before the storm. Then he knew that he must keep a firm hand on the bridle, and his attention at the highest pitch, or they would soon be wandering helplessly over the plain. He walked long distances beside the mare, with his body shielding her head and with speech and caress keeping up her courage. Their progress was slow, for the force of the storm was so great that, though it beat against them from the side, they could struggle through it only at a walk. Hour after hour went by, and the only sign of its passage was that a dim, yellowish center of illumination that had once been the sun crept slowly across the sky. As the day grew older, Conrad's pain from his injury became more acute. Most of the time he felt it only as an insistent background to the keen outward discomfort of stinging sand and pounding wind. But when an occasional sharper twinge brought it more vividly to his consciousness, he swore a little between his teeth and thought of the letter he was going to write to Delmay Baxter. The particles of sand filled his hair and encrusted his face and neck until they were of a uniform brick red. Constant effort and encouragement were necessary to keep Brown Betty in the road. And finally he was compelled to walk at her head most of the time and, with a guiding hand on her bridle, counteract the unflagging urge of her instinct to drift before the blast. Thus they battled their way through the hot, beating wind and suffocating sand, while that vague core of light moved athwart the dirty heavens, dropped slowly down the western sky, and was swallowed up in the denser banks of dusk above the horizon. It had been too dark before for the discernment of objects, but a yellowish glare had filtered through the sand-laden air, lending a lurid semi-translucence to the atmosphere. Now even that was gone, leaving a desert enveloped in pitchy darkness, while the wind roared about the ears of the travelers and pounded their bodies as with cudgels, and the sand pelted their skins. Most of the time Curtis depended upon the feel of the road under his feet to maintain his direction, but now and then it was necessary for him to get down on his hands and knees in order to recover the track from which they had begun to stray. Once his fingers came in contact with a small feathered body. The bird tried to start up under his hand. He knew it must be disabled and placed it inside his shirt. Thus they plodded on through the night and the storm, the pain in his shoulder growing keener, and the torture of the wind and sand ever more nerve-wracking. At last the mare raised her head and gave a long whinny. Conrad felt sure that she was announcing their near approach to the food and shelter within the adobe houses. "What is it, Betty? Do you know where we are?" he asked. And she rubbed her nose against his face, nickered, and pulled at the bridle with the evident desire to turn from the direction they were pursuing. Curtis knew they were in a little hollow, and thought it might be that into which the road dipped after leaving the houses. "All right, Betty," he said. "I'll follow your lead a little way, but be cautious, old girl, and don't tie up to any lying hunches." He slackened his hold on the bridle, and the mare started off eagerly. They climbed a hill, and presently Conrad was aware of a black mass before him. Putting out his hand, he felt an adobe wall. The mare crowded close against it and stopped. She had left the road, which took the hill at a long sloping angle from the foot of the rise, and had climbed straight up the steep incline. He felt his way around the corner, unfastened the door, and entered. An emphatic "whew!" gave vent to his feeling of relief. The mare, close at his heels, snorted in response, and Curtis, smiling in the dark, threw his arm across her neck in fellowship and said, "Feels good, doesn't it, Betty B., to get out of that hurricane from hell?" By the light of a lantern, he led the mare to the spring, stabling her afterward in one of the houses. "In the best society, Betty Brown," he explained, "it's not considered good form for horses to sleep in men's houses. But you deserve the best I can give you tonight. Blessed if you don't, old girl, and you shall have it, too." He gathered together for her food and her bed the alfalfa hay from several of the bunks, and found for her also a small measure of oats. Then, having attended to her wants, he looked about for something to stay his own hunger. It was his custom to keep some canned provisions in the place, as the station was much used by his men. On a little smoldering fire in one corner of the room, he made some tea in a tin can. A frying pan hung against the wall, and in it, awkwardly fumbling with his one useful hand, he contrived to warm a stew of tinned chili con carne and pilot bread. Fine sand drifted in and settled in a red dust over the food as he ate, and he could feel its grit between his teeth. The bird he had carried in his bosom he found to be a southwestern tanager. Its pinkish red plumage shone with a silvery radiance in the lamplight. One of its legs was broken, and one wing had been injured. "I'll take it to Miss Bancroft," he said aloud, "and she'll care for it till it can shift for itself again, poor little devil." With intense satisfaction, Conrad at last sat down to the letter in which he had all day been longing to express his feelings. "I wonder," he thought, "if Delmay Baxter did it because he don't like the things I say about him. Well, he'll have to get used to it then, for I'm not going to quit." There was a grim smile on his face as he wrote, "I consider it the square thing to tell you that I am on to the game of your man, Jose Gonzalez. We had our first set to this morning, in which he winged me, but I got the best of him. I could have killed him if I had wanted to, but he is such a good cowboy I hated to do him up. I am going to keep him in my employ, but I want you to understand distinctly that if he makes another crack at me, I shall go to Santa Fe as quick as I can get there and make a Christmas gift of you to the devil before you know what's happening. Yours truly, Curtis Conrad. P.S. I am still shouting for Johnny Martinez for Congress. C.C. "There," he exclaimed, as he sealed the envelope and threw it down contemptuously. "I sure reckon he won't be so anxious for me to turn up my toes with my boots on after he reads that." The pain in Conrad's arm and shoulder had become so keen that he could not sleep. He lay in his bunk listening to the rattling of the door and the rage of the wind against the house, seeking to keep his mind from the stabbing pain long enough to sink into unconsciousness. But no sooner did his eyelids begin to close down heavily than a fresh throb made him start up again wide awake. This irritated him more than did the other suffering, and finally he jumped up angrily, found a copy of Lecky's History of European Morals, and with the muttered comment, "This is about what I need tonight," settled himself on an empty cracker box and read the night away. Toward morning, he became aware that the wind was abating, and a little later that less sand was drifting into his retreat. Breakfast was eaten and Brown Betty cared for by lamplight, and with the first dim rays of morning he set out once more upon the road. The bird was again in his bosom, and the cactus, wrapped in old newspapers, rested at the back of his saddle. The storm had passed, but the air was still full of dust particles through which the sun shone, red and smoky. Curtis knew that these would settle gradually with the passing hours, and the sky become as clear as usual. Already he could see the road for several rods in front of him, and that was all he needed to keep it flying under Brown Betty's feet. At the ranch house, Mrs. Peters told him that a man had been there looking for work and described his appearance. "Yes, he overtook us at Rock Springs, and I hired him," Conrad said. Then, remembering the account Andy Miller had given of his previous situation, he asked her if the man had said where he came from. "No," she replied, "he didn't say where he'd been working, but he came from toward Golden." The superintendent thought the discrepancy rather curious, but decided it was nothing more than a not unusual cowboy eccentricity of statement. He resumed his journey with no misgivings, and mid-afternoon found him arguing with the physician at Golden that he might just as well start back to the roundup that same night. End of chapter 11.
Chapter 12 of The Delafield Affair by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 12. The First Shot. Alexander Bancroft sat in his private room with Curtis Conrad's return checks before him. They were not many, one in favor of his brother at the University of Michigan, one for a mail-order house in Chicago, a small one to a New York publishing concern, and his eyes fell upon the name of Rutherford Jenkins and the amount, $500. He stared at the slip of paper for a moment, conviction rushing to his mind that his pursuer knew the truth. Then he took his revolver from his pocket and examined its chambers. "I may have to do him up myself," he thought, his lips tightening. But sudden hesitation gripped his heart. Until within a few weeks he had considered Curtis one of his best friends, and had liked the young cattleman wholeheartedly, admiring him and enjoying his impulsiveness, his geniality, his ardent loyalty to his friends, and his equally ardent hostility to those he disliked. Now the good fellowship he had been accustomed to feel stopped his hand. "Can it be possible," he asked himself for the 100th time, "that this eager-hearted, companionable fellow will really carry out his deadly purpose?" He recalled the intensity with which Conrad had spoken of his long quest for revenge, his vehemence toward his enemies, his impetuosity. Again conviction grew strong upon him that when the man knew, the end would come. The frontier code by which he had lived so long nerved his heart, and he muttered, "He shan't smash things. Now, I'll smash him before I'll let him do that." He swung the revolver into position and took sight. As his eye glanced down the barrel, he saw that it was pointing at Lucy's pictured face, smiling down from the top of his desk. His hand shook as he laid down the weapon. There was a knock at the door, and he made sudden pretense of close attention to the papers before him. The door partly opened, and he heard Conrad's voice outside. Surety of imminent peril seized Bancroft's mind. The instinct of self-defense sent his hand to his revolver, and he sprang up, pulling the trigger. Curtis rushed in at the report, calling out, "What's the matter, Alec?" The banker had just time to stay his finger at the sight of the friendly face and solicitous manner. "I didn't hurt you, did I, Curt?" he asked anxiously, sinking back in his chair and looking at Conrad's arm, helpless, in a sling. The bullet, they found, had nicked the top of the door and buried itself in the ceiling. "I was looking my revolver over when you knocked," Bancroft explained, "and had just been aiming at that spot on the wall. My finger must have pulled the trigger unconsciously. The thing's set to a hair anyway. I must have it fixed. What's the matter with your arm, Curt?" In the revulsion of feeling that swept over him as he realized that the cattleman was as friendly as ever and that therefore his secret was still safe, he felt genuinely thankful that his bullet had gone wild. Conrad told of his fight with Jose Gonzalez. "You're getting the truth about it, Alec," he went on, "but to everybody else I'm saying that I got horned by a steer.
knocked over, and my collarbone cracked. I'm convinced it's some of Del Baxter's work. I reckon I've been saying out loud just what he is too often to please him, but the letter I've sent him will buffalo him quick enough. Jose's a good cowboy, and I'm going to keep him, but I don't want the boys to know anything about our little scrap, so I'm saying it was a steer on the prod that did it. Bancroft's thoughts were active as he lighted his cigar. That check, it must have been Castleton money, to be handled for Johnny Martinez. Perhaps security might still be compassed without bloodshed. In thankfulness that he had not killed the man who was still his friend, he revolted against the purpose of the Mexican, to which he knew in his soul he had given tacit consent. He did not want this cordial, confiding, good fellow struck down, if his own safety could be otherwise secured.
"You'd better give the Mexican his time, Curt. He's locoed, probably. When you get back, you may find he's killed half your men."
"Well, if he tries running amok in that gang," the superintendent responded cheerfully, "he'll never do anybody else any harm. Anyway, I've settled him for the present. I busted his knife and threw the pieces into the pond. No, he's in Dell's pay. That's all there is to it. And when Del reads my letter, he'll hike to call his man off. I don't expect any more trouble from Jose."
Bancroft made no reply, and Conrad went on. "By the way, Alec, for a full minute yesterday I thought Baxter must be my man. The man I'm after, you know, Delafield. I found out that he's somebody rich and respectable here in New Mexico, and when I felt that Baxter must be responsible for this attack on me, I lit on him for my meat. But it was too good to be true. As soon as I thought it over, I saw that Baxter couldn't be Delafield. But they're two of a kind, all right. Both of them have got their freight loaded ready to pull out for hell at the drop of a hat. Baxter will have to pull his in less than three jumps of a bucking horse if he doesn't call off his man. And Delafield will be pulling his mighty soon anyway."
Bancroft made a gesture of annoyance. "Curt, you talk too easily about killing. You'd make a stranger think you're a bad man of the border instead of the decent citizen you are. For heaven's sake, man, why don't you come to your senses and see what an ass you'll be making of yourself if you try to carry out this fool scheme of revenge that's got hold of you? Why don't you accept his offer to pay back the money as fast as he can? Let him make restitution and keep a whole skin. Perhaps you'll save your own scalp in the bargain."
The seeker after vengeance laughed blithely. "Alec, you've no idea what this thing means to me. Why, man, you talk as if giving up that plan would be no more than changing my coat. You don't know, Alec. Why, to get the drop on Delafield and hold him while I tell him what he is in language that will scald him from head to foot, and then deal out to him the death he deserves, that's the one thing I've lived for all these 15 years. I'm obliged to you for your advice, Alec, but I know what I'm about."
Bancroft shrank away a little as Curtis talked. His lips tightened as he picked up the revolver and sighted it at a calendar on the wall. After a moment's silence, he looked the other full in the eye and said impressively, "You forgot one thing, Curt. If this man Delafield knows what you are doing, and you seem to feel sure he does, he'll be prepared for your attack, and you're not likely to have things your own way. Unless he's a fool or a coward, he'll defend himself, even if he has to kill you doing it. And if he has any sabe at all, he'll be loaded for you when you get there, and have the drop on you before you can say a word."
"Chances of war," Conrad replied serenely. "He's welcome to all he can get, but I'm betting my last dollar and my scalp in the bargain that he can't draw as quick as I can, nor shoot as straight. You bet your life, Alec, when that circus comes off, I'll be the star performer."
"Well," said Bancroft slowly, "if you won't listen to reason, I suppose you have to go on, hell-bent, in the gate you struck, and take the consequences. But you are fool to do it, and I hate to see you making such a blind ass of yourself." Curtis laughed, undisturbed. "That's all right, Alec. I don't expect you to get the joy out of this business that I shall."
He went over to Bancroft's desk and picked up the revolver, examining its sights.
"They're not right, Alec," he said. "When I get the use of my arm again, I'll fix them for you. And you don't use your gun right when you want to take quick aim. You don't swing up quickly and steadily as if you were used to it. You ought to practice, Alec. Out here a man never knows when he may have to defend himself. I've got to stay here several days, the doctor says, and while I'm here, I'll show you a few tricks."
"All right, if you like," Bancroft replied, adding, as he pocketed his revolver, "I'm not a very good shot, and as you say, out here a man never knows when he may have to defend himself."
Conrad, turning to go, lingered awkwardly. "By the way, Alec," he blurted out, "it has occurred to me that perhaps you are getting tied up with Del Baxter too tight for comfort. I don't want to seem curious about your affairs, you know, and I haven't got any big pile. You know what my balance is. But whatever I have got, you're welcome to, any time, if you want to cut loose from Baxter, and it will help any." Bancroft hid a grim smile behind the hand at his mustache as he thought of sundry checks of his own making their way toward Conrad's balance. "Thank you, Curt. It's very kind and thoughtful of you to make the offer, and I appreciate it. But I don't need anything. Baxter and I are in partnership in a number of enterprises, but it's all straight sailing."
"That's good, and I'm glad to hear it. I was afraid he'd got you under his thumb. But remember, Alec, that my small pile is at your disposal any time it will be of use to you."
As the young man left the bank, he saw Lucy Bancroft turn the corner toward the Mexican quarter, and was quickly at her side, relieving her of the little bundle she carried. She was going to Senora Melgares, she explained, who could wash laces and embroideries and all kinds of dainty things beautifully with a mole root. She was taking her some of Miss Dent's and her own fineries, and hoped to get her a great deal of work from others. "The poor thing," said Lucy earnestly, her eyes wide and soft with sympathy, "she is so heartbroken over the affair. You've heard? Mr. Gaines died the other day, and Melgares has been indicted for murder. My father says he'll surely be found guilty, and will probably be hanged. The poor senora." When they reached the little adobe house, Lucy asked Curtis to go in with her, saying, "I'm not very sure of my Spanish, and I'd be glad to have you come in and help me out." They found Senora Melgares sitting with her head buried in her arms, her hair disheveled, and her face, when she raised it, eloquent of grief and despair. But she greeted them with grave and gracious courtesy. Lucy impulsively took her hand and held it in both of her own, while she presented Senor Conrad. At the name, the woman drew her slight figure together with a convulsive movement, her dark face lighting with interest.
"Don Curtis? Senor Don Curtis Conrad?" she asked eagerly.
"The same, senora," he answered in Spanish, bowing gravely. "The same whose mare—" she began, her expressive countenance finishing the query. Conrad bowed again. The woman sank down in her chair, her face in her hands, swaying back and forth as she moaned and sobbed. Lucy knelt by her side to comfort her, while Curtis bent over the girlish figure and spoke in a low, changed tone that the girl barely recognized, so different was it from his usual brisk utterance. It set her nerves vibrating in quick, half-conscious conviction of a depth and quality of feeling in harmony with her own.
"I am afraid I made a mistake by coming in, Miss Bancroft," he said. "It did not occur to me that she would connect me with her husband's trouble. Won't you please tell her, when she is quieter, that I am very sorry about the whole affair, that I have no feeling against him, and that I'll gladly do for him whatever I can? I think I'd better go now, but I'll wait outside for you, and if I can be of any use, you must call me."
When Lucy joined him a little later, her face showed signs of tears, and as they walked back she was preoccupied and perturbed. She wished to see her father, so Curtis left her at the door of the bank.
"Daddy!" Lucy exclaimed as she rushed to his side, her eyes shining and her face aglow. "Oh, Daddy, Senora Megadis has just told me the strangest thing. Mr. Conrad was with me, but he went out because she cried so, and he didn't hear what she said. I tried to quiet and comfort her, and finally she told me that her husband had been persuaded and paid to steal Mr. Conrad's horse by a man who said he wanted to get even with him for something. She told me his name. You and Mr. Tillinghurst and Judge Banks were talking about him the other day. Mr. Jenkins, Don Rutherford Jenkins, she called him."
Anticipation warmed Bancroft's heart as she spoke. If the story was true, it might give him just the hold on Jenkins that he wanted. He made her repeat the details of her conversation with the Mexican woman. "Did you say anything about it to Conrad?" he asked in conclusion.
"No, Daddy. I thought I ought to tell you about it first."
"Quite right, Lucy. You were very prudent. And don't mention it now to him or to anybody."
"No, of course not. But, Daddy, won't that make it better for poor Jose Maria? Mr. Jenkins is the one that ought to be punished, he and Mr. Baxter, and poor ignorant Melgares ought to be let off very easily. Don't you think so, Daddy?"
One of her hands rested on his shoulder. He took the other in both of his as he smiled at her indulgently. Her news had so heartened him that he hardly noticed her connection of Baxter
with the affair. I don't know about that, daughter. It isn't likely to have any effect because his indictment is for murder. You know he killed Gaines while resisting arrest, and his motive in stealing the horse has no connection with that crime. I'm glad you told me about it, dear. I'll talk with Melgares myself and see what can be done. I suppose his wife must be having a hard time. You might give her some money, and ask her, he said as he handed Lucy some bills, not to speak about this Jenkins matter to any one else. Be sure you impress that upon her. It's a pretty bad case, but you can tell his wife that everything possible will be done for him. Dell Baxter is coming down to undertake his defense. He does it for nothing, so you mustn't think so badly of him hereafter when you see how willing he is to make what amends he can to the poor fellow. Lucy threw her arms about his neck and kissed his forehead. Daddy, you're awfully good and kind, the best man in the world. About Mr. Baxter, though... She paused to toss her head, and a little sparkle shone in her eyes. Well, I'm glad he has the decency to do it, but it's no more than he ought. And before I think much better of him, I'll wait to see if he drives any more of the poor Mexicans out of their homes. Bancroft began to plan hopefully. He would see Melgares and get the exact facts. If this story was true, it would be just the sword he needed to hang over Jenkins. Evidently, he had told Conrad nothing. Therefore, that check must have been campaign money from Ned Castleton to be used for the benefit of Martinez. Jenkins would not be likely to talk. It would ruin his chance of making money out of it for himself. As for Curtis, perhaps, after all, he would not be unreasonable about the offer to make restitution. Another check would reach him soon, with assurance of more to follow speedily. Surely the man was too sensible to cast aside such a start in life as this money would give him, just to carry out a crazy notion that would end in his own ruin. But if he will go on, he'll have nobody but himself to blame for whatever happens, he thought. I've given him fair warning. The encouragement he felt turned his thoughts toward Louise Dent. In the intimacy of their daily life since she had been Lucy's visitor, he had found her ever more lovable. He began to think, as he looked into her eyes and felt the restrained sweetness of her manner, that when he should be free to speak, she would welcome his feeling and have for it an intoxicating return. But he could say nothing until the settlement of this affair left no further danger of discovery and disgrace. She must not know, neither she nor Lucy shall know. Never, never a word or hint, he thought desperately. True, Louise was not so unsparing in her moral judgments as Lucy. She was older, and with more knowledge of the world, had more tolerance for the conditions under which men lived and worked. But if all that past, the past that he had believed buried beyond resurrection, should suddenly confront him, she and Lucy would be horrified. They would despise him. The respect, honor, and love for which he hungered would die. If they stayed beside him, it would only be for compassion's sake. In the fierce mood that possessed him as he thought of going down again into dishonor, he was ready to strike out at anybody's pity. This thing must not be. He had won his way back to position, power, affluence. He held the love and honor of his daughter and of the woman he hoped to make his wife. What he had won, he would keep. His lips whitened as he struck the desk with his clenched fist. The past is dead, and it's got to stay dead, he muttered. I'll win out yet, by God. End of chapter 12. Chapter 13 of the Delafield Affair, by Florence Finch Kelly. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 13, The Second Shot. 4 days later, the physician gave Conrad dubious permission to return to the roundup. Well, I may as well say you can go, he surrendered, since you are determined to go anyway. But don't blame me if your wounds get worse. Most of this time, the cattleman spent at the Bancrofts, where Lucy and Miss Dent tried to make an invalid of him, and all three enjoyed the comradeship that straightway sprang up among them. Between Lucy and Curtis there was much bantering gaiety, but when alone their talk was sure to flow into serious channels. They had many long conversations, wherein each was deeply interested in everything the other said. They had much music also, Miss Dent playing and the others singing duets. Lucy was very happy. She beamed and sparkled with glowing eyes and dimpling smiles, and her manner, the whole being of her, expanded into maturer womanliness. Between Miss Dent and Conrad there was from the first a mutual liking, which quickly developed into confidential friendship. On his last day in town, While helping Lucy water the plants in her conservatory, he spoke to her admiringly of Miss Dent.
"I'm so glad you like my dearie," she responded warmly, looking up at him with a glow of pleasure. "She's the dearest, sweetest woman, and you always feel you can depend on her. If you put your hand out, you always know just where you can find Louise Dent, and you know she'll be as firm as a rock. She's been so good to me, and she's always so restful and calm. She has so much poise. But do you know," she hesitated as she stopped in front of the cage that held the tanager Curtis had brought for her care. His physician had splinted its broken leg and bound its injured wing, and together they were anxiously watching its recovery. "It's been eating, Mr. Conrad," she broke off joyously. "Let's give it more seeds and fresh water." As they ministered to the bird's needs, Curtis went on about Miss Dent. "Yes, she seems to have a calm sort of nature, but when I look at her, I find myself wondering if that is because she has never been moved very deeply, or because she keeps things hidden deep down. Her eyes are set rather close together, which generally means, you know, an ability to get on the prod if necessary, and sometimes there is a look in them that makes you feel as if she might break out into something unexpected." Lucy was looking up at him with the keenest interest in her face. The southwestern sun had kissed her skin into rich browns and reds, and she carried gracefully her slender, girlish figure. Her head, with its covering of short brown curls always held alertly, gave to her aspect a savor of piquant charm. Curtis looked down into her upturned face and eager eyes with admiration in his own. Under her absorption in the subject of their talk, she felt herself thrilled with sweet, vague happiness. "Do you know, I've been feeling that very same thing about dearie," she said in confidential tones. "She seems more restless lately, although I know she's perfectly happy here with us. She has just the same quiet, gentle manner, but it seems as if there might be a volcano under it. Not really, you know, but as if there might be, if, I don't quite know how to say it, if things just got ready for it to be a volcano."
"Do you think anybody would know it?" asked Conrad, "even if it was really there?"
"I know what you mean. Yes, she has wonderful self-control. I never saw anybody who could hide her feelings as she can, and always does. I've been thinking lately that if Deary were in love," Lucy hesitated a moment while a deeper glow stained her cheek, "she's just the sort of woman to do anything, anything at all, for the sake of it."
"Yes, and not get excited over it either," added Curtis. When Lucy went to attend some household duties, Conrad sauntered out to the veranda, where he found Miss Dent with her sewing. He happened to refer to his boyhood, and she asked some questions that led him to speak of his youthful struggles. She was interested, and wanted to know the cause of his father's financial ruin. He hesitated before replying. The matter touched so nearly the secret core of his life and thought. Few, even among his intimates, knew anything about the vengeful purpose that had motivated half his life, and he disliked ordinarily to say anything about the cause of his early misfortunes. But the habit of close and friendly speech into which he and Louise had fallen, coupled perhaps with a softening of feeling toward her sex that had been going on within him, moved him to openness. "It won't matter," he thought. "She's such a level-headed woman, and I've told Alec already." "I don't often speak about it," he said, "but I don't mind telling you, for you are such a good friend of the Bancrofts, and Alec knows the story. Of course, you'll understand that I don't care to have it discussed generally. My father's disasters all came from his getting caught in a specious financial scheme engineered by one Sumner L. Delafield of Boston." An indrawn breath, sharp and sudden, made him look quickly at his companion. "Have you hurt yourself?" he asked solicitously. "Oh, I jabbed my needle under my thumbnail. Such an awkward thing to do. It gave me a little shock, that's all. Go on, please. What sort of a scheme was it?" He told her briefly the story of his father's ruin and death, and outlined the transactions that led to Delafield's failure. As he spoke, his heart waxed hot against the man who had caused the tragedy, as it always did when he thought long upon the subject, and he went on impulsively to tell her of his long-cherished purpose of revenge. She listened with drooped eyelids, and when she spoke, at his first pause, there was a slight quaver in her voice. "You don't mean that you really intend to kill the man?"
"I do, that very thing. What's more, it's my notion that killing is too gentle for his deserts, for, of course, my case is only one out of many, and any man who would deliberately bring ruin and death into so many households, don't you think yourself he's worse than any murderer?"
She forced herself to raise her eyes, and once she had met his gaze, her own was cool and steady. But if Curtis had not been so absorbed in their discussion, he might have seen that her face was paler than usual, and her manner nervous, as she replied earnestly, "But you forget, Mr. Conrad, that the man had no intention of doing these things, and that probably he involved himself in as much financial disaster as he did others. I've heard of the case before. I knew some people once who were concerned in it, who lost money by it. And I've always understood that the failure was due more to Delafield's sanguine temperament and overconfidence in his plans than to any deliberate wrongdoing. Don't you think, Mr. Conrad, that killing is a rather severe punishment for mistakes of judgment?" He answered with the rapid speech and quick gestures he was wont to use when under the stress of strong feeling, "I can't take that lenient view of the case, Miss Dent. My conviction is that he got some money out of the affair, though not as much as he is generally supposed to have taken, and ran away with it. I've studied the case pretty thoroughly, and I've trailed him along from one place to another for years. I'm hot on his tracks now, and he knows it. I've followed him into New Mexico, and I know he's somebody in this territory, prosperous and respectable. He can't escape me much longer." She had been thinking intently as she studied the expression of his face. It's not worthwhile to try argument or persuasion with him. Opposition would only make him obstinate, was her conclusion. Her manner was as composed as usual, and only her eyes showed a trace of anxiety as she spoke, slowly and thoughtfully, her gaze searching his countenance. "Well, if you say you are going to take revenge upon him in this savage way, I suppose you will do it, if that chin of yours means anything. You haven't asked my opinion, but I'm going to tell you anyway that it seems to me unwise and unjust, and most unworthy of you, to allow such an idea to become the obsession that this one has. But I want to know how you managed to keep your family together. That was a wonderful thing for a boy of 15 to do." "Oh, I don't deserve so much credit for it. Of course, I couldn't have done it without help. Our guardian wanted to distribute us children around among the relatives, but I wouldn't have it that way, and begged so hard that at last he gave in. Two of my father's cousins lent money enough to pay off the mortgage on our home, on our guardian's representation that he should be able to save enough out of the wreck to pay it back in time. He did so, and we children kept a roof over our heads. A cousin of my mother's, a widow without children, offered to live with us and keep house. We rented part of the place and lived in close quarters in what was left. I worked like a Turk at anything and everything that brought in a penny, and so, altogether, we had enough to eat and wear, and I was able to keep the girls and Homer in school. I went to night school and sat up reading anything I could get my hands on when I ought to have been in bed. It was hard sledding sometimes, but we pulled through, and I had good friends who saw that I was never out of a job of some sort. After a while, our cousin married again and left us, but by that time my sisters were old enough to take charge of the housekeeping, and we got on very well. 10 years ago they both married, and I said to Homer, 'Let's sell the house and give the money to the girls. You and I can shift for ourselves, and we don't want them to go to their husbands with nothing at all.' The kid was game, and so we sold the place and divided the money between Helen and Jeanette. Then I put Homer in school and struck out for myself. I've sent him to college, and he'll be graduated next year. But he's worked right along and helped himself a heap. There's sure good stuff in the lad. This summer I'm not going to let him work. The rest of the way is clear enough now, and I want him to come down here with me and learn to rope a steer and bust a bronco and go camping and have a good out-of-doors time of it for his last college vacation." As she listened with her eyes fixed upon his face, Miss Dent's attention had been half upon his story and half upon the man behind it, searching out his character through his words. The conviction settled in her mind that his vengeful intention was rooted deep, and that the more he talked of it, the more sap would he become in his purpose. "I like your story," she said. "It is one of those tales of human effort that make one have more faith in human nature. But the climax you intend to put upon it is horrible." He noticed the slight movement of repulsion with which she spoke the word. "But that's your affair," she went on. "Did I understand you? Did you say," in spite of her self-control, she was stumbling over the question. She masked her momentary confusion with an absorbed interest in getting her sewing together. "Did you say that Mr. Bancroft knows that you have told him this story?" "Yes, I told him the outlines of it a little while ago, apropos of a check I had from Delafield. The rascal thinks he can buy me off that way. That shows he's buffaloed, but he'll find out I'm not that sort." No, I shouldn't think you were. But Lucy, does she know anything about it?
He looked up in surprise.
Why, no, of course not.
Bancroft was coming through the gate, bringing Judge Banks with him, and Lucy joined them a moment later. The talk turned on the coming trial of Jose Maria Melgares, the narrow escape from Pendleton from Melgares' bullet, and the death of Gaines as the result of his own foolhardy horseplay. They spoke of little Jack Wilder's skill with the revolver, and Conrad reminded Bancroft of their agreement to do some target practice together.
"Let's all go out in the backyard now," Lucy exclaimed, "and Miss Dent and I will shoot, too. Wouldn't you like it, dearie? Come on. It will be such fun."
While they were setting up the target, Sheriff Tillinghurst came to speak to Judge Banks upon an official matter, and Lucy asked him to stay and help her shoot.
"You all use my gun, Miss Lucy, and then you'll be sure to have good luck,"
he replied, drawing his revolver from his pocket. It was a small pearl-handled six-shooter, which the ladies admired, and the men jibed at for its daintiness.
"That's all right," he answered good-naturedly. "This gun don't stack up much beside a cannon for size, but I can pervade and pester with it a right smart heap if I want to. It's a peach of a shooter, and it don't show in my clothes. I never have anything on me but that, and I've never seen the gun play yet where I got the worst of it. You all try it, Miss Lucy."
Lucy took the revolver, telling him that now she would be his deputy, and with plentiful instruction from Curtis, placed herself in position and fired. She hit the bullseye and won much applause until she explained that she had fired with both eyes shut, and that if she had made a good shot, it was because she couldn't help it with such a splendid gun as Mr. Tillinghurst's. Miss Dent took careful aim and, without lowering her arm, emptied the remaining chambers, making an excellent score. She, too, won a round of applause, to which she replied calmly, "Oh, I've known how to shoot for years, and when I am in practice I do fairly well."
"You two fellows shoot a match," said Tillinghurst to Bancroft and Conrad. "The judge will be umpire, and each fellow use his own gun at 30 paces.
Louise and Lucy stood at one side, where the sheriff and Judge Banks joined them, leaving Bancroft and Conrad to begin their match. Beneath her calm exterior, Miss Dent's thoughts were in a tumult, and fierce resentment against the cattleman was rising in her heart. Had not Alex suffered enough already? Why should he be hunted down like this when he was willing to make restitution, even after all these years? Oh, cruel to beat him down again, when he had won success and respect once more. This man was a savage in his implacable desire for revenge.
Curtis raised his revolver. With both eyes open and without pausing to take aim, he sent a bullet through the bullseye.
"Delafield won't have much chance against a man who can do that," he exclaimed in a triumphant undertone to Bancroft. As the test of the skill went on, it developed that the banker excelled if he took time to aim accurately, while he of Socorro Springs was the superior at quick shooting.
"It's my specialty in the shooting line," said Curtis. "You'd better practice it, Alec. It's the thing that counts most if you get into a scrimmage."
He handed his hat, a wide-brimmed gray felt, to Judge Banks, asking him to throw it up, adding, "I'd do it myself if my left arm wasn't in dry dock." He raised his revolver as the hat left the judge's hand. There were three quick reports, and he sprang forward and caught the descending sombrero on the muzzle of his pistol. The three perforations in the crown of the hat were so close together that a silver dollar covered them.
"Bravo!" exclaimed the judge. "I don't know but two other men who can do that. Little Jack Wilder never misses the trick, and Emerson Meade, over at Las Plumas, does it as if he were a machine and couldn't miss. If you ever get a grudge against me, Mr. Conrad, I'll engage the undertaker and order my tombstone at once."
Bancroft turned away quickly. He swung his arm upward, fired, and found that his bullet had hardly nicked the outer rim of the target.
"Don't pay any attention to your gun," Curtis admonished him. "Keep both eyes open, look at the bullseye, and unconsciously you'll aim right at it. If you get into a gunplay where it's a choice between giving up the ghost yourself or getting the other fellows, you want to fasten your eyes on his most accessible part, point your gun that way, and shoot on the wink. Between the eyes is a good place, for then you can hold him with your own.
That's the way I shall fix Delafield," he added, dropping his voice. Cold anger seized upon Bancroft as the picture of that gun muzzle close to his own forehead came vividly into his imagination. Until now, Conrad had not mentioned the subject of Delafield to him since the day of his return to town,
and the banker's friendly feelings had renewed themselves with the growth of his own confidence and with his desire to compass what he wished without violence. But Curtis had only to speak of his purpose in this cold-blooded manner for the banker to know that he, too, was rapidly becoming as implacable as his pursuer. Judge Banks was talking to Miss Dent about the view and the New Mexican climate and quoting Wordsworth on the witchery of the soft blue sky. She was compelling an expression of smiling interest, while her thoughts were with Bancroft and his danger. The desire possessed her to stand near him, to hover about him, as if her mere presence would protect him from peril. The friendly revolver practice between the two men made her sick at heart, and she was waiting with inward impatience for the moment when she could propose returning to the veranda. Lucy and Sheriff Tillinghurst were laughing and talking together in a running game of playful coquetry on her part and admiring badinage on his. "Now, Miss Lucy," he was saying, "if you all are going to be my deputy, you'll have to learn to shoot with at least one eye open. I can't have my deputy shooting around promiscuous with both eyes shut. It might be used against me in the campaign." "Oh, I'll keep both eyes open, just as Mr. Conrad says," she exclaimed, taking the sheriff's revolver from his hand. "Just like this," she went on gaily, pointing the pistol straight at Curtis's face as he came toward them, saying, "Now you must have another chance, Miss Bancroft." Tillinghurst sprang forward as he saw her level the revolver and struck it up with his hand. Her pressure on the trigger had been light, but the contraction of her finger as the sheriff knocked it upward discharged the weapon. The bullet sang through the air, and she paled and staggered backward, looking wildly from one to the other as she exclaimed, "Oh, I was sure it wasn't loaded." "A gentleman's gun is always loaded, Miss Lucy," said the sheriff, mild reproof in his tone. Lucy leaned, trembling, against Miss Dent's supporting arm. I was sure we shot out all the bullets," she stammered, looking wistfully at Conrad. "I'll never, never touch a gun again." "Don't feel so worried, Miss Bancroft," urged Curtis gently. "You weren't pressing the trigger, and I'd have ducked if you had, for I was watching your hand. I wasn't in the least danger, and you mustn't think about it again. It'll be your turn next, Miss Dent," he added jocosely. "Alec had his the other day and sent a bullet into the wall just above my head." "And you still have confidence in us, you reckless man," Louise exclaimed with a little effort at gaiety, but with eyes on the ground. "Perhaps he thinks he'll be in less danger if he teaches you all how to handle your guns," the sheriff commented, as Miss Dent led the way back to the house. End of chapter 13.